sensational. You're so hypnotic, magical.
Hypnotic magical.
so hypnotic, magical, cold, 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 cold.
After a strong opening to their home season, expectations remain high for the Jumbo football team as Coach Civetti and his high-octane offense found stars new and old to end their homecoming weekend with a bang. But now, their season stands at a crossroads, with both the Bows and their opponents today sitting at 1-1. One will exit Medford with a winning record, the other will not. This is Tufts University Football, only on JumboCast. Well, it's a chilly Saturday. It's a chilly Saturday afternoon here at the Ellis Oval, and while we're hoping to stay dry, the Jumbos are looking to exit Ellis Oval today with a 2-1 record as they face off in NESCAC football action against the William College Eves. Welcome, everybody, to the Jumbo Zone, where we will get you ready for NESCAC play on the floor in which it will be played. My name is Andrew Howe. I am joined alongside Riley Daniel today. Riley, great to have you today. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling great. I mean, obviously, with these two teams here, it's always a great matchup when Williams comes to town. It was a great matchup last year, and we anticipate another phenomenal matchup here today. We're so excited to be here to be able to break it down for you.
We're going to get into how the last time these two teams faced off a little bit later. But first, we got to start off with how things unfolded at homecoming weekend. The Jumbos started things off at Ellis Oval for 2023 with a bang and starting off with the coin toss as President Sunil Kumar joined the Jumbos for his first home football game as head of Tufts University. Early in the game, rain prevented both quarterbacks from passing, but it did not stop Michael Berluti from running. A 61-yard rush gives the Jumbos their first touchdown at Ellis for the 2023 season.
Yeah, I mean, this play, as Henry Burns right pointed out on color, this play wouldn't be possible without that crucial block on the outside from Jaden Richardson. The Jumbos have really relied on receiver blocking, and they'll need to do it again today.
Second, Bates didn't let things go out of hand, though. Marcos Ruiz kicked a 23-yard field goal to make it 7-3. Second quarter, Berluti sets back, and look at this absolute gem. Finds the spot right to Cade Moore. An athletic play from both ends, Riley.
Yeah, I mean, there's nowhere else he could have put that ball. Cade Moore, a ridiculous catch.
See, take a look at that in the slow-mo. After another tough field goal, score remained at 17-3. Colton Bosselet needed to make something happen for the Bobcats. Finds a huge pass to Sergio Beltran. That's a name that you're going to be hearing a lot. That brings them within 10 on that next play. The same people, the same result. Bosselet to Beltran does give Bates their first touchdown. Berluti leads a huge drive left with 48 seconds to go, trying to find the icing on top of the cake in the form of Henry Flechner, but barely out of bounds, not able to find both feet into that end zone. So instead, it's Vaughn Steele kicking a field goal, sending the Jumbos into the half with a 20-10 lead. Start of the second half, Jumbos trying to pick up right where they left off. Berluti looking to find an angle and tries and finds the score, but oh wait. There was a holding call. That touchdown, Riley, got sent back.
Yeah, it did, but that again shows the danger that Berluti possesses, not just in the air, but on the ground, and the read option always is a threat for the Jumbos offense.
Jumbos had to settle for a field goal. Could be signs of momentum for Bates. Cut it to one score if they get a good play here, but unfortunately, it looked like that was an interception by Lewis Timmons. The Jumbos got the ball right back and did not kind of keep their foot off the brake the rest of the way. The final score at Ellis Oval, 44-16. You could take a look at that game summary here, Riley, and really all Tufts-centric from start to finish.
Yeah, I mean, they come out, build themselves a 17-3 lead, and Bates, you said it earlier when we were talking, had a chance. The blocked kick really was their last any semblance of having momentum. The Jumbos just ran away with that towards the end of the game.
It was a really fun time to watch here. Under the lights, homecoming weekend, a great time all around, and while people like Berluti, Cade Moore, who we saw put up some phenomenal plays, were certainly a big factor. The biggest factor of them all for the Jumbos was their running back in Chartellus Reese. We're going to take a look at some of his highlights, but this guy had such an incredible performance throughout this game at Ellis.
Yeah, I mean, it was crazy. 2 weeks ago, we were talking about Chartellus Reese in terms of his defensive play, and then here he is just absolutely destroying the Bates defense on the ground. Two touchdowns. Earn himself an SCAC Player of the Week, rightfully so, in my opinion.
Just the amount of power that he has as well. You can see in the replays here some big clips of him powering through some of those defensive lines and really showed no signs of stopping. You know, was listed also as a defensive end, and you can see some of that power in the way that he plays the offensive game.
Yeah, and that gives the Jumbos something that they haven't had in recent years, which is the ability to really just power through the center of the defense instead of having to go to those outside draws, those pitches. They can really attack on both levels here in terms of the run game.
And as you can see, Chartellus Reese, winner of that NESCAC Player of the Week. Got a cool graphic just to show you the amount that he was able to do. 20 total rushing attempts, 178 yards. The biggest one were those two rushing touchdowns, which brought the Jumbos over the hump.
Yeah, I mean, when he was needed, he stepped up that second rushing touchdown. I mean, as soon as that one went in, I turned in the stands and I was like, that's game over, because you could just see on the Bates sideline the energy just completely deflate as they just realized they weren't going to be able to stop Chartellus Reese.
And it'll be interesting to see. You know, Reese didn't get a ton of action in the first game, but after that second game, you have to imagine, you know, he gets a huge chunk of those offensive plays. It is good passing weather right now, unless some more rain comes down. But for the most part, we are expecting Reese to be a big factor once again.
Yeah, I mean, I would be shocked, and I'd have some distinct questions for Coach Civetti if Reese is not the fundamental factor in this offense today. If not, just to set up the play-action pass and give more space and time to Berluti and let him use his arm. You develop the run early on with Reese, and then you can look to air it out later when the defense is putting seven in the box.
Well, we talked about the offensive game here for the Jumbos. We can also talk a little bit about the special teams here, because a big thing that we've been seeing from Tufts over these last couple weeks, and we saw specifically in that game against Bates last week, is their field goal defense, or just their kick blocking defense. Obviously on this play late in that game, Christian Rosario, big highlight, blocking that extra point against the Bobcats last week. And if that seemed to remind you of anything, that's because blocked field goals are something the Jumbo special teams unit is very familiar with. In fact, nearly a year ago to this day, on October 1st, 2022, against that same Williams East team that they're playing, it was Michael Michael Butler that got a hand on the ball, and Victor Garza ran it all the way back into the end zone to tie the game up at 14. Ended up being a very crucial swing as Tufts won that game 35-28. If Garza didn't score that touchdown, would have been a very different story.
I mean, yeah, they lose that game. That's a 10-point swing when you take the field goal off the board and turn it into 7 going the other way. In a game you win by 7, that's the difference between a win and a loss. And with these two teams both coming in 1-1, it's very likely that one play could decide today's game just as well.
You can see right here, 9 blocked kick attempts since the start of 2021 for the Jumbo Special Teams unit. That is the second most in the NESCAC, only behind Hamilton. We're going to take a short break in just a couple of minutes, but before we do so, you may notice throughout the game that the Jumbo football head coach Jay Civetti and his staff will all be wearing patches on their sleeves in support of the Coach to Cure MD program. The Jumbos are among thousands of coaches joining forces today to raise awareness and funding for Duchenne muscular dystrophy. DMD is a progressive genetic muscle disorder that affects around 1 in 5,000 boys worldwide, and as of now, there is no cure. However, Coach to Cure MD has raised $2.1 million over the past decade and have funded critical research and care initiatives that have extended the life expectancy of those diagnosed with Duchenne by at least 10 years. If you'd like to help, you can use the hashtag #TackleDuchenne, text CURE to 501501 to contribute $25, or visit CoachToCureMD.org to make a donation. That's CoachToCureMD.org. We're going to take a short break here on the Jumbo Zone. When we return, we'll take a closer look at the Jumbo's opponents for the day, the Williams Eves. Welcome back, everybody, to the Jumbo Zone. Once again, just want to take a quick look through that blocked field goal by Christian Rosario, a big highlight once again versus the Bobcats. And we were talking about some stuff that we saw last year as well, and we're going to have to cast your eyes back to October 1st, 2022, where against the Williams Eves, it was Michael Butler to block a field goal at the end of that first half, and the ball was picked up by Victor Garza, ran it all the way back to the end zone, as we were saying, bringing the Jumbos back to a 14-14 game entering the first half, ended up winning 35-28. Welcome back, everybody, here on the Ellis Oval. Andrew Howe alongside Riley Daniel here as we get ready for NESCAC football here on a pretty brisk, cloudy Saturday afternoon. Riley, of course, I want to talk a little bit more about just the matchups that we have around the NESCAC, as all of them prove to be important. We have that graphic for you right now. We'll make sure to keep you updated as we come back here during halftime. But is there any game here, Riley, that sticks out to you specifically?
Yeah, I mean, looking at it, I mean, obviously you have that Amherst-Trinity matchup. Amherst is going to be coming up for the Jumbos in 2 weeks, so a big matchup. And obviously they've already played Trinity, so I think that matchup could kind of give you a little bit of a gauge as to which teams in this NESCAC season are going to be legit and which teams are going to struggle a little bit more.
Yeah, let's start talking about the Jumbos' opponents today in Williams. We saw there last year these two teams played in Williams, and it was a 35-28 win for Tufts. And Williams has had two NESCAC championships over the past 12 years. However, as you see here, have been a little bit all over the place. Finished off that 2021 campaign, and then right afterwards, 3-6. It's hard to gauge where exactly this team is coming into this season.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, the NESCAC is historically known in pretty much every sport as being very difficult and very competitive. And looking back at some of these results, you can see games that are won or lost by single-digit, single-score margins. And it could just be the case that some years they're winning those competitive games. They have what it takes to close it out. Some years they just can't. I mean, there was that four-year stretch from 2013 to 2016 where they lost, had a losing record every season. They've seemingly rebounded in 2019 and 2021, had a tough year last year, or 1-1 so far this year. We'll see today, really, what they're made of.
Yeah, kind of a litmus test. You know, in baseball, you have those three-game rubber matches where after you're 1-1, that last game really determines what direction you're going to be going into the rest of the year and just in terms of momentum. And for both of these teams, they are facing that situation today. Now, when we take a look at which players are going to be of the most impact in this matchup, our eyes immediately, Riley, have to turn to the run as we see Chartellus Reese going to face off against Mario Fischetti. These two players, top of their class in the NESCAC this year.
Yeah, I mean, you got someone in Fischetti who, I mean, he's second in rush attempts, second in rush yards. The only guy he's behind is Chartellus Reese, who put up over 200 rushing yards a week ago, 222 on the year, third in the NESCAC, 8.2 rushing yards per carry. But Fischetti offers something a little bit that Reese doesn't, and that is he is a threat in the receiving game as well, has three catches for 21 yards, and so he can give his offense something that Reese might not be able to. So we'll see if Williams can take advantage of that and if Reese can do to the Williams defense, which has a little bit more of a stronger defensive line, what he could do to that Bates defensive line last week and just run right through him.
I'm going to offer a proposition to you, Riley. Over under 0.5 tackles for Reese here today.
I'm going to say under only because I don't see him getting on the field defensively if he runs through the Williams defense the way I see him doing it.
I mean, if he's such a good offensive player, you don't necessarily need him to play at both ends. And so after bursting onto the scene last week, winning NESCAC Player of the Week, I think I'd be inclined to agree with you there.
Yeah, I kind of agree with you on that one, Andrew. I mean, it'll be interesting to see, though, because if it becomes a very tight game, as we kind of foresee it becoming, you could see Coach Rivetti wanting him out there because he is so strong on that defensive line towards the end of that fourth quarter, and maybe he does get a tackle towards the end of that game.
Something we'll see a little bit later today. Now, I know the running backs are the biggest matchup today, but we got to take a look at another matchup that might be on the top of our minds, and that is how these two mascots, the Jumbo and the Eef, we have to look up, an Eef is actually like a type of cow, as you can see in their logo. Riley, take us through the tape right now between these two
teams. I mean, obviously you got the elephant versus cow matchup. I mean, yeah, you got the color. I don't really think color really has much of an effect in who's gonna win this fight. Height definitely will. I mean, you got the Jumbo that's 12'6", 13,000 pounds. I mean, yeah, an Eef's a ton, but it's only 4'10" tall. So Jumbo's just gonna be able to use that height advantage, get those tusks down. I mean, horns just don't have the same sort of extension that tusks do. I think the only chance the Eef has is running away with its top speed of 25 miles an hour. The problem is the Jumbo can match that speed, and if the Jumbo catches the Eef, it's game over.
Some friendly giants. I don't even know if they'd want to go after each other. It would probably take a pack of cows, though, to even match the might of the Jumbo. We're inching closer and closer to game time as we are now minutes away from our fictitious battle of mascots being brought to life. Thanks for joining us here on the Jumbo Zone. Riley and I will be right back here at halftime to break everything down, so make sure to stay tuned. We're going to take a short break when we return. It'll be Jared Cohen and Henry Burns with the call.
Welcome back to the Ellis Oval for this production of Tufts football here at JumboCast. Today, the 1-1 Tufts Jumbos take on the 1-1 Williams College Eefs. My name is Jared Cohen. I'm joined here by my good friend Henry Burns on color commentary. The Jumbos and Eefs are coming off of opposite results last week. The Jumbos got their first win of the season in a dominant display against Bates, while Williams was shut out by an upstart Bowdoin roster. Henry, what do both teams need to do to come out of this week above 500?
Well, unfortunately, Jared, only one team can come out of this week above 500. But if the Bows want to come out on top, here's how they're going to have to do it. Last week, we saw the Jumbos overwhelm Bates with the ground game. This Eefs defense is much stingier than the Bobcats, so using Reese early will help open up Berluti's passing windows down the stretch. And speaking of Berluti in the passing game, last week was quiet for Tufts through the air, with star wide receiver Jaden Richardson only having one catch for 15 yards. Williams will present a much tougher challenge than Bates, and both the passing and rushing fronts have to be firing on all cylinders. Turning it over to the defense, Williams is a run-first team. Tufts gave up 100 yards on the ground last week and will need to hold Williams running back Mario Fischetti under 100 yards as he is the second leading rusher in the NESCAC currently. Now, if Williams wants to steal one away from Tufts on the road, here's what they're going to have to do. This is a defensive-minded team with head coach Mark Raymond at the helm. They need to neutralize the high-scoring Jumbo's offense. Williams is letting up 21 points per game, and this Tufts team is second in scoring in the NESCAC through two games. On the offensive side, Williams freshman quarterback Owen McHugh has taken over behind center. The tandem of McHugh and Fischetti has found great success on the ground, and they shouldn't turn away from it this week. When you have an inexperienced signal caller, turnovers can be a game killer. This Tufts defense led the league in interceptions last year, so McHugh needs to be smart with his decisions and not let an early turnover dictate the game.
Thank you, Henry. A lot of interesting narratives coming into today's game for sure. I think we've got two teams that have struggled at times this season, but two teams that have a lot of potential on both sides of the ball. Williams is a team with a lot of size, especially in the trenches, both on offense and defense. And Tufts, of course, has an offense that we've seen in the past can really take off at any given moment. So we should be in store for a great matchup today. Hopefully the stands continue to fill up as we get closer to kickoff here. We're going to send over to a quick intro video for the Tufts football team, and we will be right back.
Remember back in the day when you taught me to live and I taught you to pray. We went in the battle together, no matter the weather, we never delayed. You gave me commands, I always obeyed. I never let you go astray. I never thought I'd see the day that you would come and just betray me. Sick of playing silly games, you never loved me anyway. You should not have let me get away, cause now I'm hunting for my prey. I'm bigger, I'm better, my mind is a weapon. I won't ever let up, you try to break me down and I'ma just get up. They ask me how I did it, I'ma just tell them I rose up. I'm a survivor, fight for my life. I'm stronger. I will arrive. I'm a survivor. Fight for my life. Coming back stronger. I will arrive.
Welcome back. That was a little quick video courtesy of the Tufts Athletic Department. Looking again at this matchup, I think one of the things that jumps out off the bat is the matchup between the two running backs on our teams here. We've got Chartellus Reese for Tufts and, of course, Mario Fischetti for Williams, both guys who can make a big impact. Fischetti has been an impact player on this Williams team for a couple years now. He was on the championship team in 2021. Meanwhile, Reese kind of burst onto the scene last week. What are we looking at in this matchup?
Well, I think you kind of just said it right there, Jared. Reese busted on the scene last week, but week one, he was quiet. Out of his 222 yards, which puts him first in the NESCAC in rushing, 178 of those came last week. And I guess today, really, we'll see if that was the big boys up front for Tufts just dominating Bates' defensive line, or if this is something for real that Tufts has. Because after that performance, Reese, like I just said, is first in the NESCAC in rushing. But right on his tail is Mario Fischetti coming in second place with 198 yards, and he's a proven rusher.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Reese, last week, after that big performance against Bates, named NESCAC Football Offensive Player of the Week, D3football.com National Team of the Week. A lot of buzz around this guy since he broke onto the scene last week. He was playing defense before that, was listed at linebacker, but he runs real hard, and he's an impact player. We saw that. Question is, again, was that a product of the Bates defense, or is he really a guy that they can stick with the whole season? Fischetti, I think we know that Williams has a lot of faith in him and that he's going to be a focal point of their offense going forward.
Yeah, you see the 8.2 yards per carry for Reese. That's really tough to uphold through more than a week, especially against a stingy front like Williams has. They have huge defensive linemen, bigger than Tufts in almost every single position on their D-line versus Tufts' offense. So we'll have to see if that large yards per carry number can withstand this the test of time.
And with that, we are getting close to kickoff here at the Ellis Oval. We'll go away for just 1 second for the coin toss and national anthem, and we will be right back here on JumboCast.
So hypnotic, magical. Go, 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 go.
And we are back once again as we are getting closer to kickoff here at the Ellis Oval, Tufts versus Williams. Last thing before we get to kickoff, looking at a little offensive comparison between our two teams today. Two offenses that have been going in separate directions so far this season. Tufts, an offensive powerhouse last season. It is the core of their team. Williams wants to see more out of their offense than what they've seen so far. Henry, what do you see?
Well, you'll see average time of possession by Williams. They have about 28 minutes per game, and that's key. When you run the ball a lot, you're going to have a lot of time of possession. However, when you rack up the time of possession like that, you better be scoring on your drives, because when you're playing against Tufts, every time they have the ball, they're pretty much a threat to score a touchdown. So if you're going to hang on to the ball for 28 minutes a game, you better be converting into 7 points every single time.
Yeah, I expect to see Tufts coming out throwing. I think they're going to move the ball a lot quicker on offense. We've seen that. 31 points per game, of course, kind of skewed between their two games, but their average time possession less than Williams. I think you're right. If Williams wants to stay in this, they're going to need to be more efficient on offense. 12.5 points per game is not going to get it done. Of course, they were shut out last week, but they're going to need to be consistent on both sides offensively if they're going to keep up with a Tufts offense that we know can go off at any time. But, of course, Williams, they've got size on defense, and they can they can make plays happen as we are underway here at the Ellis Oval. Kickoff fielded and down to the 12-yard line is Andre Smith, the return man for the Jumbos, and the offense will come out to start the game. Tufts did win the toss and elected to receive. And Michael Berluti will lead the Tufts offense out onto the field. Coming into today, they are averaging 31.5 points per game and 484 passing yards and 373 rushing yards coming into the game. Berluti lines up at quarterback. Jaden Richardson out wide. In the shotgun, man in motion is C.J. Burton. Berluti takes a snap, looks to pass. Immediately quick to Jaden Richardson, his top target, and they get on the board immediately with a quick completion.
I love the start with a pass, a quick game pass right there to Jaden Richardson. He just matched his total catches from last week on the first play of the game. This is exactly what Tufts needs to do to take control of this game. Berluti's strength is throwing the ball.
We've seen this before. Getting your guys in rhythm early, really a big key, and I think you're going to continue to see them look at Jaden Richardson as we go on. Berluti again in the shotgun. This time a handoff to Reese. Cuts upfield and Drayton's a tackler with him close to a first down.
Going to be interesting to see how Williams handles this super jumbo package from Tufts. When they send in seven big guys like that, you really have to be big up front. Williams has a ton of height up front. As you can see, they're only playing with three down linemen, which means they trust only three guys to get in there as opposed to the traditional four front from most teams because they're usually undersized.
It will be third and three on the 25-yard line as Tufts comes Berluti in the shotgun yet again. Two receivers out wide, three in the slot. Berluti looking to pass. He's going to take a shot, and he's got a man that is caught down to the 40-yard line, Cade Moore.
Great read right there by Berluti. Williams, interestingly enough, was in a cover three look right there, found the hole between the linebacker and the corner, just waited for his man, Cade Moore, to come right into the window.
Yeah, good patient throwing from Berluti there, something we know he can do. He has been in control of this Tufts offense since the minute he took over 2 years ago as a freshman, and he shows no sign of letting up. Berluti again keeps it on a option play with Reese, cuts upfield, and will gain around 4 yards. A staple of the Tufts offense is the read option.
I have to imagine all week, though, Jay Civetti has been salivating at this Williams front because they usually take number seven, Ethan Scott, and they rush him off the edge. Very easy read for a quarterback if it's a stand-up linebacker firing off the edge like that. You saw number seven turn both his shoulders, came right down the line. Berluti, easy read on the pull. Obviously, you know, Williams recovered, but still a nice four-yard pickup.
Fleckner and Richardson split out. Two men in the backfield with Berluti. Moore in motion. Berluti looks his way. He's going to tuck it and run and gains maybe a yard. Ball might have come out there at the end. Williams says that they have it. See a call on the field. Ball is in the hands of a Williams player. I think they're going to rule him down by contact before the ball came out.
Yeah, he looked like he got a little bailed out right there by, I think, his knee or elbow touchdown. But that was a huge play from Williams up front. This size is going to be a big factor all day. You look out there, you can see it on camera. They are just standing taller and wider than that Tufts offensive line front.
Austin Demmel came out with the ball right there, but again, ruled down. And Berluti, with alone in the backfield, is going to look to throw again. That ball is caught, but short of the line, it looks like. Strong tackle there from Ethan Scott.
Yeah, C.J. Burton split out. It looked like Hitches across the board with the outside wide receiver running deep to just pull the safety deep. Unfortunate. Usually that's like a stick route. You want to have your receiver stop right down at the stick and get the first down. But good job by Williams staying on top of that and pushing him back in front of the sticks, forcing Tufts to punt this big defensive possession.
Coming out to punt is Patrick Walsh. He will let that one go long and low. Punt bounces around the 20. And we'll take a Tufts bounce to around the 13-yard line, which is where Williams will take over.
Yeah, that's a poison call right there if you're Williams. You get all your men away from that ball. The low rolling punts are terrible. You have no idea where it's going to bounce. If it ricochets off one of your guys, that's a live ball for Tufts.
And so if you're Williams, a strong start to the game. Tufts looked short often in their first drive. Couldn't convert on third down, and now Williams will take over. Not great field position, but we'll see what they can do with it. And at quarterback will be the freshman Owen McHugh for Williams. McHugh hands off to Fischetti. Mario Fischetti takes it to around the 18-yard line. Maybe a little short of that. It will be second down.
Yeah, interesting to see Tufts come out in a cover two zone look. They have seven guys in the box. That's four down linemen and three linebackers behind them. It looks like this is going to be their approach to stopping the run.
And I think if you look at the way Williams lines up on offense, they don't have a ton of size outside, but they have a lot of size in the trenches. So we'll see what they can do. Man in motion, handoff to Fischetti, cuts inside, and a gang of Jumbo's tacklers bring him to the ground.
Nice zone read play right there, dialed up by Williams. Huge hole, I believe, in the B gap. Tufts had three down linemen there, easy to double team and look to the second level if you're a Williams blocker.
Yeah, it really is an interesting matchup here. The Jumbos have a lot of great guys on defense who have shown in the past they can make plays. Ed Uteri, Shane Reiner, of course, EJ Comerford, but they're going to have to stand up to a tough Williams rushing attack today. Again, McHugh, this time looking to pass, looks deep down the right side of the field. That was intended for Holden Gehring, but it was incomplete, just overshot him a bit.
Yeah, there's the traditional Tufts cover one man look. Great read by the freshman. It looked like he had a step. Holden Gehring had a step on the DB, but Jameer Alves was over top, lurking. I like the shot play, though, on first down. You know you're down in distance. You can take a shot always on first and 10.
I agree, and I don't think we're going to see Williams be shy to take shots down the field. I think they need to get big chunk plays when they can, and they're going to be going after that. Paul Harshberger split out wide, excuse me. McHugh looks to pass quickly, finds his man, and he is tackled, a gain of around three. That was, excuse me,
freshman running back Thorbon.
Luke Thorbon, correct, out of Norwell, Massachusetts. He gets his first action of the young season, and it will be third and six from the 28-yard line.
Seemed like a design screen pass on second and long. I kind of like the call. Out of the tight bunch left look, you got a lot of guys out in front of him. Picked up a solid gain.
Williams looking to keep the ball moving here early in the first quarter. McHugh looking to pass again. He's going to try to find his man on a drag route. Again, that was Holden Gehring. Gehring wanted a flag. Nothing comes out, and they will look to punt.
Yeah, I think Gehring might have been right there to demand a flag. Looked like Reiner sort of grabbed the back of his jersey and came over top with his arm. But nonetheless, good. It was blanket coverage all around, and even if that pass was completed, he would have still been 4 or 5 yards short of the sticks.
Yeah, I think Reiner may have gone to him a little bit early, draped over his arm right there, but no call will benefit the Jumbos. And out comes the punt team led by Tim Brown, the senior from West Newton, Massachusetts. He's a big guy for a punter, 6 foot tall, 215 pounds. He will let this one go. That is a long punt. Smith calls a fair catch, at the 21-yard line, and that is where the Jumbos will take back over on offense, unable to get anything going. Either team was on their first drive, but a second chance here for the Jumbos, 9 minutes and 5 seconds left in the first quarter.
Yeah, if you're Berluti, you're really proud of your defense stepping up, not allowing a long drive from Williams. You get the ball right back. You're essentially in the same spot you had it before, and you get a do-over.
And you like to see what works, what doesn't work. Of course, we saw them go quick early on the first drive. See what they come out with here. Again, big Jumbo look on the offensive line right here. Can't really get much bigger than that. Berluti drops back. He's looking deep. He's got a man. That's Cade Moore. That ball is broken up, incomplete. A shot down the field from Berluti comes up just short. He had a man. He saw him, but good pass breakup right there.
I love that matchup, Cade Moore on freshman DB Wyatt Cotton. You have to expose the youth on the secondary. That was our key last week for Bates, but it's always the key because playing DB is one of the hardest positions in football, and if you're young at it, there's nothing that gets you better at it than just more time on the field. So if you're a freshman, you just don't have a lot of time yet.
Yeah, Cotton again split out wide one-on-one with Moore. This time it will be a handoff to Reese charging forward for a gain of around 2 yards.
Yeah, hasn't been able to get loose yet. Williams, I'm assuming, would have schemed up quite the game plan to counter Reese after his huge performance last week. But after two or three carries, he's really has not seen that same 8.3 yards per carry.
Yeah, and I think, as you said earlier, hard to repeat that performance in back-to-back weeks. Hasn't gotten it going, but we're still early here. See if Tufts continues to pound the rock, try to find some lanes. Corners are split way out off of the receivers. See if Berluti looks to take advantage. Drops back to pass. Quick throw into double coverage, but that ball is caught by Jaden Richardson, and that will be close to a first down. He caught that with a man blanketed all over him.
Yeah, good sit route right there by Jaden Richardson. Looked like they were playing off in a cover four, which is an interesting call on third and long because you know they're going to be going for the stick, so you sometimes want to get aggressive. Cover four is a little bit loose. Richardson, I guess they got him down short 1 yard, so it ended up working out. But Richardson sat down about a 10-yard hitch right at the sticks, and for the second time in a row, that stick route has not worked.
Yeah, I think Tufts is looking for these timing routes, and they are, you know, hitting on them. But again, 1 yard short, that snap was a little bit low, and the punt spirals out of bounds at around the 25-yard line. We'll see where they spot that. Again, looked short of the sticks on third down and couldn't get it. That's the price you pay when you don't look downfield.
Yeah, I think they took their shot play, though, on the play before to Cade Moore. It hit off his hands. That's something you, as a quarterback, you want to get your connection early going to your star wide receiver. But nonetheless, let's see if the Tufts defense can step up here and provide another reset for the offense.
And as McHugh comes back on the field coming into today, he had 276 passing yards, 2 touchdowns, and has rushed the ball for 97 yards so far. Also has thrown 1 interception. We'll see what happens on this drive. Fischetti in the backfield. Excuse me, that is not McHugh. That is Jack Dickinson in at quarterback. And Dickinson takes a power up the middle for around 3 yards. So they are utilizing a rotation here at quarterback, it seems.
Well, it's sort of, again, similar to what we saw last week with Bates. They were rotating the quarterbacks in. But as you see, Dickinson's coming back out and McHugh's coming back in. Dickinson primarily functions as a wildcat running back at this point. He started the first game against Colby, got about the first quarter and a little bit in the second. And then ever since, it's been McHugh's signal calling.
Yeah, Dickinson had 187 yards and 4 touchdowns on the ground in 2022, so it makes sense for them to use him as a rusher, but McHugh is back in the game. That ball is broken up. Looks like it will be ruled incomplete on the play. That was Ed Uteri, the stout defensive tackle for the Jumbos, makes a great play there, puts his arm in the passing lane, and it will be third down already.
Yeah, it looked like McHugh quickly went through his route, his reads. It was double slants on the left side with a tight end into the flats. He turned away from it really fast, though, to the little flat route by the running back out of the backfield.
So now presumably Williams will look to pass again on third down. A lot of quick third downs for both teams so far as they look to get into a rhythm. McHugh surveys, lofts one, and that will be just out of the reach of Bryce Cooper, his sophomore wide receiver. No flags fly, and we will see another punt. Already the third punt we've seen today, and there's still 7 minutes left in the first quarter.
Yeah, great coverage by Tufts there. Forced him to put it in the bucket, and McHugh didn't make the throw. I think he had a step. The receiver had a step on the DB, but that's the type of coverage you want to do with cover one. Force the quarterback to put it in the tight windows. Force your wide receivers to make moves. Another punt coming from Tufts. Let's see if they can reset.
Tim Brown back to punt yet again. Uncorks a long one. That is returned. Makes a move and hit hard at the 20-yard line. They like to, and you're right, we've seen a couple of the same plays. Let's see what they do right here. Berluti with Reese in the backfield. It is a handoff to Reese up the middle.
Yep, good chunk play right there. That's what that stay on schedule, 5 yards on first down.
Chunk play is what they're looking for. 2 offensive linemen go in motion.
Yeah.
Jack Lynch.
Look at how light Williams is in the box. They have 6 guys in the box against tough 7.
Yep, and that's exactly what they saw as well. Reese will take that for a first down, and that left side was wide open. I think Berluti saw that. They adjusted, and a little zone run left. and an easy first down.
Yeah, you're spot on, Jared. As a quarterback, first thing you do is you count. You look in the box, you see six guys out there. Well, I have seven blockers, 7-on-6. That's a mismatch. Run that ball all day.
And I think exploiting matchups like that will be key for the Jumbos as they proceed against a stout Williams defense. Several guys there, big, and can get after both the rusher and the passer, looking specifically for number 91, Cameron Smith, who leads the NESCAC in tackles for loss so far this season. Berluti hands off again, but a whistle and a false start on the Jumbos will take them back 5 yards.
Yeah, it looked like they were going to stay on schedule with another run play on first down. I'd love to see Tufts break into the second level of the defense with the rushes, because when you sit in a cover three with a one high look, it forces your safety to be a player. He's got to be a run stopper and a pass stopper. It's number two, Austin Demmel, sitting over top. Nothing has gone that far yet, but once you break the second level, you are free in a cover three.
Berluti's got Fleckner split out to his right, Richardson far to his left. He's going to pass. Pass rush comes. He looks downfield on another long comeback route. That one is caught by Fleckner, and that will be close to a first down following the false start.
Yeah, we saw Fleckner have success last week. He's got a lot of speed. He's a center fielder. Usually it's on the deep ball. He can get out there and run underneath those long looping passes. Love to see the footwork and the technique on the comeback route. That's a big chunk play after the 5-yard penalty.
Yeah, Fleckner led the Tufts baseball team in stolen bases last year with 25. It's his first year on the roster. He's already out there getting playing time. I think they know what kind of athletic talent he is and looking for him early. Second and three now from the 48-yard line. Berluti with Reese again in the backfield will keep it on the read option, cut inside. He's got room to run, and he is down to the 43-yard line. A first down and a strong run from Michael Berluti.
Yep, sometimes football is just a numbers game like that. Again, a simple pull read from Berluti. When you have the trip set out to the left, you're spreading the defense out. He's gotten way fewer people in the box. He made the cut back, the jump cut back inside, and put his head down and had a nice pickup.
The strongest offensive drive from either team so far is underway with the Jumbos right now as Berluti looks for a play call from the sidelines. They're really sticking with the Berluti-Reese personnel. It seems like Reese has really taken this starting running back role and will continue to be a large part of this offense. Again, Berluti looks to pass, looking deep down the right side of the field. That ball is broken up at the last second. He intended that for Cade Moore, and it just came up short. Put the ball on the goal line, one-on-one play, but no dice right there. They're looking that way. At some point, you have to think they're going to hit on it.
Yeah, that's the second time they've dialed up a deep ball to Cade Moore. I love this early on, though. You stretched the Williams DBs out. You make them fear the deep ball, and that's when those stick routes open up. That's when they play soft, they back off, and you can get them short.
Back again, three wide receivers out wide, two men in the backfield. Berluti again looking to pass, fires one over the middle of the field, caught, and makes a move. That is Henry Fleckner again, and they will have another Tufts first down.
Yep, simple concept right there with the seam route and a dig coming in. When you run the seam route, it runs the safety off, and then the dig is wide open. The dig is usually a 10-yard in. The safety backs so far off because he sees his key read is that number two wide receiver, the inside wide receiver who's going deep. And so he goes deep, the in route is wide open.
And we're seeing Berluti, an equal opportunity passer, looking all ways. More Fleckner, Richardson so far as he rushes right and will go down maybe a gain of one.
Yeah, it looked a little indecisive on which way he wanted to lead off of his lead blockers. But, I got good play by Williams to hold him up in the backfield.
And now in the red zone somewhere that the Jumbos have been very strong so far, not quite in the red zone yet, excuse me, if they can get there. They are 8-for-10 so far in terms of scoring in the red zone this season. So odds look good if they can get a first down right here on 2nd and 10. Berluti is going to hand that one off to Reese. Cuts right. He's got room. He is on his way. And that is a touchdown. Chartellus Reese following up his all-nation team of the week performance last week with another one right there, and it is 6-0 Jumbos.
Yeah, that's an all-nation run right there by Chartellus Reese. Third touchdown on the season, two last week, One this week. You got to be sick if you're the Williams defensive coordinator. You knew they were going to pound the rock with Reese, and they just ran it at will on that drive.
Yeah, offensive line opened up a huge gap on the right side, but give credit to Reese. Again, as I said, he was the D3Football.com National Team of the Week last week, NESCAC Football Offensive Player of the Week, and he's following it up again with another strong performance. Jumbos jump out to an early lead as they attempt an extra point, and that one is up, and it is no good. Excuse me. Multiple flags fly on the extra point attempt. We'll see what the call is. Team is staying on the field. Here is the call. It looks like it's on the defense. Illegal substitution against Williams. They might bring out the offense to go for two. They could elect to decline the penalty. We'll see.
Yeah, it looks like they're going to keep Von Selick out on the field and get another attempt. He was on the NESCAC honor roll last week for his perfect performance against Bates.
And special teams, always a big aspect. Past years, Tufts has been hurt by inconsistent play on special teams, led to a couple losses that could have been wins. This year, looking a little bit different. Selick and Walsh both been strong so far. Selick 3-for-3 on field goals. They'll come out and attempt another extra point here. Penalty assessed as half the distance to the goal.
5-for-5 on PATs as well. Last season, I believe he went 38-for-40. Really rarely misses these.
Selick, ball down. And he knocks it through. The extra point is good. That makes it 7-0 Tufts. With 2 minutes and 54 seconds left in the first quarter, they've taken an early lead on the rushing touchdown from Chartellus Reese, and Williams will look to respond.
I was worried I was going to do the old announcer kicker jinx right there when I said he rarely misses these, and then they usually shank one into the parking lot.
I thought we would learn not to do that.
Well, you know, only the second time in the booth, you like to test your will. Going to be interesting to see how Williams responds, though. Really had minimal offensive success, but they've taken a few shot plays. I'd like to see them go back to those deep balls, especially if it's a cover one look. You got some speed. You got to trust your quarterback and your new wide receivers.
Yep, and now we're going to send it down to the sideline. We've got Riley Daniel with a report.
Riley Daniel here for JumboCast on the sideline. I had a chance to talk to Coach Jay Civetti pregame. He was talking about his plan to let the running game really get developed here in the first quarter to open it up for Michael Belluti. We saw that there on that third drive. Jumbos were finally able to get some points on the board, have a 7-0 lead. Back to you guys in the booth.
And we're back. Thank you, Riley. The return, from Williams breaks upfield and down to around the 35-yard line. Yeah, as Riley said, Coach Civetti looking to pound the rock today. No surprise that the Jumbos want to establish the run early. They've done that. Now the question is, can Williams respond? Good starting field position on this drive they will have.
Yeah, I like that Tufts is establishing the run because week one against Trinity, Berluti was forced to throw the ball 53 times, and that's really tough to rely on a quarterback to do that week in and week out. So awesome to have a bell cow running back like Reese, who, when the going gets tough, you can put the ball in his hands and spread out the game a little.
Yeah, it reminded me a little bit of Mac Jones week one this year. Threw the ball like 55 times. Just you have to be able to establish a balanced offensive game plan. That goes for both teams here. Williams has definitely looked to do that early. Fischetti, obviously a centerpiece of their offensive attack, but they want to spread the ball around. They've looked for Lee. They've looked for Cooper, Gehring. See what they can do on this drive. Two men in the backfield. Looked like there might have been some movement there, and there was indeed. That looks like it'll be a false start on the offense, and that'll take him back 5 yards. So both teams hurt by false start penalties on these last two drives.
Yeah, it's still early in the season. You know, this is only week three. It's just looking a little sloppy on both sides. I don't know if there's a delay between the quarterback call and the center, but these are things that get cleaned up as the season goes on.
Williams has tight end Michael Bedard in as an extra blocker. 6'2", 260. He really is someone to help out on that offensive line. Man in motion is Cameron Lee. And that ball is handed off to Fischetti. Cuts outside, can't find the edge, and is driven out of bounds by Jeremy Zuniga, great play to set the edge right there and prevent a gain from Williams.
Yeah, Fischetti looked like a lot of speed. He broke out to the outside, but Tufts had him smothered with four or five guys gang tackling, rallying to the ball. I like to see the safety, Jameer Alves, in there on the play as well.
Three men split out wide for Williams, Fischetti in the backfield. McHugh looks to his sideline.
Yeah, they have Alves rolled down now, number 11.
And a flag comes flying in.
Looked like delay game.
Might have been another flinch on the offense. Nope, you're right, delay of game on the offense. And another penalty. Not a great start to the drive for Williams.
No, it looked like they were having trouble getting the call in from the sideline. McHugh looked a little confused. Nobody seemed to know what was going on, and unfortunately, time stops for no man. And
they're moving back. See if this impacts their play call here. It's 2nd and 19 now. Classic look on 2nd and long, running back draw, something just to pick up the yards. Don't want to force it downfield. Duff's defense can kind of sit back here a little.
Yeah, especially on defense, you usually want to look. Well, it appears they're in a cover one man, but they're playing man off 5 yards.
And again, a handoff up the middle to Fischetti. He breaks a tackle and cuts back out to the right side. He's got room down past the 50-yard line. A huge run from Mario Fischetti to flip the field on the jumbos. Met a man, but the man met his match, and Fischetti got around the edge.
Yeah, we talked about running back screen, maybe a shot play, something to get on schedule. Well, why don't you just pick up all 19 yards in one play? How about that?
And that is why Fischetti has been such a focal point of this offense. Coming into the day, 198 yards, 2nd in the NESCAC. And you know, he's averaging 5.7 yards per carry. He is an efficient runner and a huge play right there to change the script of this drive for Williams. Might look to go right back to him right there. Big jumbo package in the game for Williams, extra offensive lineman.
Yeah, and they have the senior quarterback, Jack Dickinson, in the game. Now look for a run. He doesn't really pass often.
And another penalty, that might be a timeout taken by Williams. So little miscommunication so far on this drive, bailed out by a huge play from Fischetti. 1 minute and 7 seconds left to go in the first quarter. Tufts up 7-0, but Williams driving down the field. What have we seen from both teams to work on and to build on so far?
Yeah, well, Tufts, they're establishing the run on offense. But on defense, they're really staying. They're confusing Williams, it looks like. This team is young. They have a young quarterback in, and you've seen two penalties already, a timeout now. You don't like to take your timeouts in the first quarter. It's a little early. Seems to just be a lot of miscommunications from Williams. I'd like to see in this second half, in the second quarter going on, that they clean things up and are able to run a more fluid offense.
Dickinson in at quarterback for the play. Fischetti in the backfield with him. Looks to the sideline.
Yeah, they have 7 linemen in there right now. Would be shocked if it wasn't a run.
And you're absolutely right. It's a quarterback-designed run. Dickinson breaks it up the middle but is met and driven to the ground by Shane Reiner. Huge tackle right there to prevent what could have been a larger gain.
I'm all for having a Wildcat quarterback come in, but if you never throw the ball with a Wildcat quarterback, Tufts
predictable.
Can load the box, and it's effectively mano-a-mano. I know Williams is bigger up front.
We'll have to see. Again, yeah, if we see Dickinson again, is there any formation they put him in where he is willing or able to throw? Other takes a step back on the play action, looking deep down the field. He has a man open, and that ball is dropped. Hit him in the hands. Cameron Lee had a chance at a touchdown, but broken up at the last second and falls incomplete on the coverage was number 73, I believe.
Looks like number 25.
Excuse me.
Henry, or Lewis Timmons.
Lewis Timmons, all NESCAC performer for the Jumbos, gets in there last second. Not sure if he got his hand on that ball, but
I don't know.
Prevented a touchdown for sure.
Wide receiver had a few steps on him, though. Deep post route, really got over top. I love the aggression, though.
Yeah, you want to take those shots downfield if you're Williams, and that one was one they probably should have completed. That's a low snap there for McHugh. Drops way back, looking to the flat. He's got Fischetti. Fischetti cuts inside, gets close to a first down. Gang tackle from the Jumbos. See where they spot this one.
Yeah, it seems like Fischetti is McHugh's best friend in this game. When you have experienced running back like Fischetti, he was on the team that went 9-0, won the NESCAC. As a freshman quarterback, that's what you rely on. He's a locker room guy. I'm sure they have a great relationship off the field, and that transitions onto the field. And when you get in a sticky situation like that where it's blanket coverage, all your receivers are covered, nothing's open, you look for the trustworthy guy, the guy you know that you can always find to make a play.
So as we get to the end of the first quarter here, it remains 7-0, Tufts over the Williams Eaves, but we will be returning to a 4th-and-3 from the 40-yard line. Interesting choice coming up here from Williams, whether they decide to go for it on 4th down, a little bit too short of a field to punt. Have to think this is 4-down territory. Would be a long field goal, though. Their kicker, Ivan Sharon, was a member of the All-NESCAC team last year, and but we'll see what the call is when we come back in just a minute. And the second quarter is about to get underway here. Looks like it will be a 4th down attempt from the Williams Eaves, but Dickinson is back in at quarterback. So as we talked about, is this a telegraphed run play? Fischetti's in the backfield. They may be looking to run it regardless.
Yeah, Tufts has 4 down linemen here with 3 backers right behind him. Looks like they're expecting the run. It'll be a great time to pass.
Box is absolutely stacked, and it is a designed run. Faked the toss, drives forward. That's going to be really close.
Looked like he was short. I just don't understand the play call from Williams. When you line up in that set, you know you're running the ball. Tufts loads the box. They're not a terrible team against the run. This isn't something you can expose.
So Zuniga and Jameer Alves get in there and stop Williams short on 4th down. The Tufts offense will take over a stout stand. And I agree with you there, Henry. I think maybe the fake toss to Fischetti, you're hoping that they focus on the guy who's been burning them on that drive. But again, 3 plays from Dickinson, 3 quarterback runs. At some point, they're going to have to make a change right there. As the Jumbos come back on the field, Berluti, as always, at quarterback with Reese in the backfield. Again, making a call, 2 linemen move over. And it is a handoff to Reese. He's got room, cuts middle, makes another cut, driven to the ground, but that will be a 1st down. Chartellus Reese picking up steam a little bit as the game has started to go.
Yeah, Williams really needs to put another guy in the box. When you have 7 offensive linemen out on the field, and especially then when you motion or flip your formation on them, that causes confusion in the defense, and you know you're running right behind the 2 big guys who just shifted over to the right side. Chances are it's not going to be coming back to the left. So I'd like to see him put a few more guys towards that side.
Yeah, Kent Oliver, Gus Bickert, they've been moving them around. Oliver, a former tight end. They're both big guys. They can really open up some lanes. Berluti this time keeps it on the read option, trying to get to the edge and gain some yards. He will gain around 2.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. It's like I mentioned earlier, it's a counting game. You had 7 offensive linemen overload to the right side, and Williams is persistent in this 3-lineman front, and they sent the pressure off of the right side, the Tufts left side, number 7 again. So that leaves nobody on the right side. Unfortunately, that's into the boundary, the short side of the field. So Berluti was forced out of bounds, but still pick up a 4 on 1st down.
Yeah, and even when Tufts has dropped back to pass, there hasn't been a ton of pressure on him so far. And this is a defensive line from Williams that's really a strong suit of their team. So we'll see, can they wear down the Tufts offensive line as the game goes on? That's a play action pass. Berluti is looking deep to Richardson. That ball is not going to be complete or anything close to it. He took another shot right there, but blanketed on the play was Richardson.
Yeah, that was a bit of a prayer from Berluti. I don't think he expected Richardson to really come down with that. He had 2 guys in his face as he got rid of it. So not a ton there for Tufts.
Yeah, and that was Austin Demmel on the coverage, really all over Jaden Richardson. He can really move around on defense. We've seen him in the trenches, and now we see him back guarding one-on-one, and he did a great job right there. Now will be 3rd and 6. See what the Jumbos dial up. Man in motion. Berluti looks his way, and that ball is caught, and it will be a Tufts first down. Robbie Moret, the senior wide receiver from Miami Beach, comes in, makes a play, and picks up a first down.
Yep, I like that play call. You send your four receivers out there, and you send three of them deep, and you have your guy Robbie Moret run a little drag route underneath. Again, good awareness, where to find the sticks, know your guys there, and easy first down.
Now Richardson, split out wide. Tight end Jack Elliott in as an extra blocker. Berluti's been moving the ball downfield, and he's looking at a lot of different guys as he does that. Now, over the 50-yard line, Berluti steps back to pass, looks quick pass. That ball is off the hands of Richardson. He had him open on a little comeback route, sat down in the middle, but just missed him and off of a one-hand catch, incomplete.
Yeah, you're spot on. That's one you wish you had back if you were a quarterback. But that's a play you can take on first down. You're okay. It's still second and long. I'd like to see him look back to the passing game, though.
Yeah, Doyle now, the wide receiver junior from Durham, enters the game. Really seen a lot of different guys come in at wide receiver so far for the Jumbos. I think Berluti might have just rushed that one a little bit. Pressure hasn't been there from Williams, as I said. And now we'll see what they can do on second and 10.
Yeah, trip set from Tufts.
Berluti hands the ball off to Reese, cuts right, moving with some steam and diving forward for close to another first down. We'll see what the spot is, but Reese really is moving well, just like he did last week.
Yeah, I like the call running against. You have your trip set to the left, you run the ball to the right. You only have three defenders over there, so if you have one of your linemen pull, they can block.
As they get up to the line quickly, but Reese stumbles on the attempt, and they will be short of the yard, the first down. It will now be fourth and two. We'll see what the call is, and it looks like the Jumbos offense will stay on the field, try to pick it up on fourth.
Yeah, slipped or not there, number eight, James Hemmer, was in his face, so it didn't look like that play was going anywhere. Williams was not fooled by the hurry-up look.
Yeah, tried to rush it up there and quickly get it up the middle, but obviously Williams was prepared. The Jumbos are 2-for-4 on fourth down so far this year. See if they can make that 3-for-5 on the 33-yard line. Empty look. Berluti by himself looking to pass. He's going to run. That's a great designed play right there on the QB draw, and Berluti easily picks up the first down on the right sideline.
Yeah, there's a flag out on the play, though, but I love that play call. Empty sets are my favorite. You have any play in your entire book because your quarterback is an athlete. He can make runs like that, and you have five wide receivers out in the field.
Unfortunately, that one is coming back, and it looks like now the punt team will come onto the field. So Jumbos go for it on fourth down, get it, but it's called back by a penalty, and they will now punt the ball away to Williams. So some good and some bad on that offensive possession as it remains 7-0. We have 12 minutes and 18 seconds left in the second quarter.
Yeah, if you're Williams, you can be happy with that defensive stand, but I wouldn't be satisfied. He kind of got bailed out by a holding penalty on a long Berluti run.
I think you want to see more plays made on the defensive end. Patrick Walsh boots that one high. A great punt if it can stay in, but no, it bounces into the end zone for a touchback. Good effort there on the punt and the recovery from Tufts, but no dice, and Williams will take over.
Yeah, big drive for Williams here with a little bit under 12 minutes left in the second quarter. They haven't been able to hang on to the ball very long, really only getting a first down before they're punting the ball back to Tufts. I would like to see them throw the ball. McHugh has an arm, he's got a strong arm, and he's accurate with it. Let him sling the rock a bit and try to pick apart the Tufts defense.
Yeah, Williams so far only has two first downs. Most of their yards have come on the ground. They only have 9 passing yards. They're going to have to find a way to get it going through the air.
Yeah, solid play.
Giving a little more than that. Taking a truckload of the A's in the game at quarterback. Yep. Three wide receivers split out wide, puts one in motion. And a handoff again to Fischetti following his blockers with a spin move. And he breaks away past the 50, past the 40. Two men chasing him. Can he get there? No, taken down. A touchdown-saving tackle right there from Ty Richardson. But a long run from Fischetti, he is carving up the Tufts defense. He hit a spin move, broke several tackles on that play.
Yeah, I love the motion, though. That motion acted as a pulling tackle, pulling guard, sent him right through the hole that Fischetti would follow, and just had a a truck-sized hole to run through. Got around the edge. Unfortunately, on those long breakaway runs, sometimes when you're seeing only green in front of you, your legs start to give out and you have a little wobble. And yeah, I remember the feeling. It's a little nothing you can do about it. But great pickup from Williams. That puts Fischetti close to 100 yards already.
Over 100 yards. Six attempts for 106 yards. That was a 61-yard run from Fischetti. He broke one off, couldn't make it all the way to the end zone, but again, now sets up Williams in the red zone, which is a place that they have had some inconsistent results so far this year. They are 2-for-6 in the red zone so far this season. Both of those were touchdowns. No field goals in the red zone yet this year. We'll see if they can change that either way. Run up the middle, and driven back is Fischetti.
I think they might have given Fischetti a break on that one. That looked like John Orris. But that's a. I like that they have another back coming in. Give Fischetti, give your guy a break. He just put your offense in a fantastic spot for this drive. What we talked about before, though, key of the game was keep Fischetti under 100 yards. And, well, it's.
They've already failed.
10 minutes left in the second quarter, and that's out of the window.
Looked like freshman lineman Vincent Gilchrist was in on that tackle. Now Fischetti re-enters the game. Play action fake. Looking back to throw. He's got two men, and that pass is caught for a touchdown. Williams gets on the board. That is Paul Harshberger, the senior from Schuylerville, New York. And just like that, Williams is back in this one.
Yep. Man coverage by Tufts. They identify that by motioning the guy on the right side. You see the Tufts defender follow him. Then they run a pick play on the left side, a little slant, and it clogs the gap, and your guy
– to tie the game. Extra point is up, and it is good. So 7-7, a huge drive to even the score on the 61-yard rush from Fischetti and the touchdown from McHugh to Harshberger. And, the Jumbos will look to respond here after failing to convert on fourth down and punting it away, resulting in a Williams touchdown.
Yeah, that drive combined everything that Williams is really successful at, running the ball and then using your freshman quarterback, using his arm, his talent. I mean – to be fair, his receiver was wide open, but that's more of those looks is what you want to see. Instill trust in your new guy.
It was a 13-yard touchdown to Paul Harshberger. 9 minutes, 54 seconds remaining here in the second quarter.
Yeah, I'll be interested to see how the spread continues. Right now, Berluti's passed the ball 11 times, and Reese has ran the ball 8 times. So look to see more of the balance, I guess, on this drive coming up.
Andre Smith and Jayshon Means back to return for the Jumbos. Berluti so far 7-for-11 for 59 yards, so completing his passes, but not insanely efficient yet. Henry Fleckner, his leading receiver, and of course, Jartellus Reese, 8 attempts for 67 yards and a touchdown. He is following up his performance last week with another strong one.
Yeah, and you know, that's that line, that 7-for-11 really could be 9-for-11. Those two passes to Cade Moore were catchable balls. And just got unlucky with some drops.
As that kickoff goes out of bounds, so the flag comes flying, and that ball will be moved up to the 40-yard line, I believe.
Yeah, that's a special teams mistake from Williams. Given the Jumbos the ball at the 40, that's an extra a free 20 yards just off of the kickoff.
Yeah, that's one of the biggest mistakes you can make as a special teams play. I think they were trying to kick it short, but smart play by Andre Smith to let it go, bounces out of bounds, and now, yes, the Tufts offense moving up to the 30-yard line, it looks like.
Yeah, it is worth noting Williams is kicking into the wind. It's a little difficult to kick high and long into the wind, so after the half, it'll be interesting if Williams still keeps the same short, almost squib-like kick approach.
Or a re-kick, excuse me? Huh. Maybe I'm not familiar with the rules at this level. They will be re-kicking, but they had moved back on the kickoff to the 35-yard line.
Well, getting the ball on the 40 or not, having to kick it off from the 35 is still a detriment to your team, especially, as I just mentioned, going into the wind. You know you can't get the ball there that far.
Yeah, I may have confused the NFL rules with the Division III college football rules, but as we have a re-kickoff here, Sharon kicks it off, and that is going to be returned all the way to the 35-yard line. Jayshon Means on the return and sets up Tufts with favorable field position anyways.
Yeah, Jayshon Means stole the ball right out of Andre Smith's hands. You saw him catch it, and Andre Smith stood there with his hands out like, what the heck, dude? You just took my time to shine. Grabbed it right out of his hands. Lack of communication. That's a baseball thing right there. You say,
call
I got it.
Yeah.
Yeah, call the ball when it's in the air.
Well, either way, Means made a play. Don't think Smith will be too upset about that, but it was funny. He stood there with a shocked look, it seemed like, as Berluti and the Tufts offense comes back onto the field. Tie game on the 35-yard line. Another big package of the offensive line in the game. Fleckner split out wide with Moore in the slot and Richardson to his left. Reese in the backfield. Berluti is going to hand that ball off to Reese, running hard. Gain of around 3 on first down.
Yep, staying on schedule with the run play. Berluti seemed like he was swinging his hand after that, signaling for to get the same play back again or maybe get another play rapidly.
And we've seen a lot of movement on this Tufts offensive line. Michael Maiava just coming off the field right now. They've been rotating in, guys. I think they have a lot of dudes they trust. As Berluti, the man creeping up, he's going to immediately look to throw right. That ball is caught for a first down and more. A strong play from the tight end, Jack Elliott, and they are down past the 50-yard line.
Great cover three beater. Flats are always open in the cover three. Love to see Tufts with their weird little funky heavy set. Switching up the looks. Jay Civetti usually stays pretty standard and pounds a rock out of that set, but like to see that they can motion a guy and get a passing look.
Well, so Jumbos quickly move the ball past midfield as Berluti takes a snap again, steps back to pass, looking left, stepping up in the pocket. He's going to throw that deep down the field. That ball is going to be incomplete. He was looking for Richardson, threw that to his left, moving to his right. That's a tough throw, and it did fall incomplete.
Yeah, really tough throw, especially as a righty quarterback. When you're sliding to your left, you're throwing off balance, you're throwing against your body. You're not super confident with that ability to throw, but Williams did a great job. They covered almost everything, and you took a shot there where it was either your receiver runs underneath it or
exactly.
Nobody catches it. So not a huge deal.
Yeah, he saw a one-on-one opportunity. The only way that ball really gets picked off if it's badly misthrown and short to the right. So Berluti throws that one away, in essence, tries to take a shot downfield. On this one, he hands the ball off to Reese, dragging tacklers with him, a big hit, and down after a gain of around 2. That was James Hemmer, the senior defensive back from Kenilworth, Illinois, on the tackle. He was a little shaken up on the play as well, but he'll remain in the game. And now it is 3rd and long for the Jumbos.
Yeah, that was the first time we've really seen Williams been able to penetrate the Tufts offensive line and make a stop at the line of scrimmage or in the backfield.
So 3rd and 10 upcoming, same little Jumbo look. Elliott in as an extra blocker. Richardson split out wide. Fleckner on the left side of the field. Berluti looks right and finds Elliott again. Looks like they ran that same play. Elliott close to a first down, definitely had a first down, excuse me, and they move the sticks again as the marching band plays You Can Call Me Al. The Jumbos pick up a first down.
Yeah, it looked like a cover four soft look again from Williams. They're going to that when Tufts is in the long passing downs, which I understand. However, when you have such versatile playmakers like Jaden Richardson and Cade Moore, when you're sitting so far off, they have the world in front of them. They can make whatever type of move they'd like.
And now you see Elliott flip to the left side of this formation. It will be a handoff to Reese following his blockers, pushing forward. Maybe a gain of around 1 or 2 right there.
Yeah, more good penetration from Williams up front. This is important that they keep doing that, though, because it shuts off that prolific Tufts rushing attack that you've seen in the last now 2 weeks. So it'll force Tufts to throw the ball, but I think that kind of plays right into Berluti's wheelhouse.
Yeah, again, Berluti has been efficient so far in terms of completing his passes, 9 for 14, but only 84 yards. And I think we've seen this in past years. Berluti, they like to start the game off completing quick throws, and they've taken shots downfield, and they'll continue to do that as Elliott splits out wide again. Berluti throws. That ball is caught by Fleckner, and that is another first down for Tufts. So little quick pass right there, and they move the sticks yet again.
Yeah, it's funny. They went for the same exact play they just had 2 or 3 plays ago and flipped the field. Same coverage from Williams, so you know the play is still going to work. I like seeing Berluti get a little greedy and go for the sticks rather than the flat. He had the flat wide open, but if he's reading top to bottom, so looking at your deepest route and then going to your underneath route, He saw Cade Moore sit down right in between the hole, in between the backer and the overtop corner, and found a nice completion.
Yeah, and you can see the impact that Jack Elliott has been having. You know, caught two passes already on this drive. On that one, he looks his way. Defense kind of adjusts and then looks back middle and finds his man for the first down. As a timeout is called, 6 minutes and 15 seconds left here in the second quarter, and we will be right back. And we are back here in the midst of a long Tufts drive. They are on the precipice of entering the red zone. First and 10 it will be from the 26-yard line. 7-7 is the score. Berluti in at quarterback. Bunch look on his left. Again, a jumbo package in the game. Berluti play action, looking for the end zone. He's got a man. Can he run under it? And it is caught. For the touchdown, an unbelievable grab from Jaden Richardson, one-handed, just managed to get his foot in bounds. Had me pause for a second right there, but another touchdown for the Jumbos and a beautiful one at that.
I didn't think he got it there, Jared, but apparently he did. He got a foot in. My goodness, what a catch. I love that post route over top. That Berluti to Richardson connection is next level. They love the deep ball plays.
Wow.
Great shot play.
That ball may have come out there at the end.
It looked like when he was rolling around on the ground, he didn't retain possession, but quick signal from the ref that it was a touchdown, so we'll take that.
Yeah, he kind of fumbled it in midair, got that one foot down, then hit the ground, but the ruling on the field stands as a touchdown, and it is 14-7 as the extra point goes through. So a big touchdown from Jaden Richardson, and Berluti now up to 11 for 16, 118 yards, and a touchdown. That was a 26-yard reception from Richardson to retake the lead for the Jumbos. Williams, who were just coming off of a long drive of their own, will look to respond.
Yep, great to see Jaden Richardson involved this week. You like, just as a fan, you like to see the star guys make their star plays, and that's a huge play. A one-handed grab, what more can you ask for from your number one receiver?
Yeah, Richardson last year was, you know, behind Phil Lutz and some other guys on the Tufts offense, but he was top 10 in the NESCAC, I believe, in touchdowns. He was in the top 15 in receiving yards, and he was towards the very top of the league in yards per reception. He has been a big play threat. We saw it right there. He had multiple touchdowns of over 30 yards, 40 yards last year. That one, 26, but you know, in the context of the drive, a huge play, and he has continued to be a guy that they can look to. Obviously, last week got
three. So this is a guy who's always a deep play threat, and he's
will be out the back of the end zone for a touchback. We'll see who comes out at quarterback, presumably McHugh for Williams, but as we've seen, Dickinson will come in and run the ball. He has three attempts for 8 yards, Dickinson does. Again, 2.7 yards per carry, not doing too much, but they have looked his way before. It will be McHugh to start off the drive, holding Gehring and Cameron Lee in at wide receiver.
Yeah, I'd like to see McHugh start completing a few more passes. They got to set him up with some pitch and catches, some quick games, some slants, some hitches, some outs, something easy for your quarterback to make. Not these, you know, 20-yard shot plays. You know, he's only 3 for 8 so far.
And I think they might look to Fischetti to start off this drive. Indeed, they do. Fischetti takes the run outside and is quickly met and taken down. Looks like that will be Michael Butler, the grad student, on the tackle and might have lost a yard there. Will be 2nd and 11, so strong push from Michael Butler and the Tufts defensive line.
Yeah, that's when you have a rookie signal caller like that. He had his wide receiver wide open, which would have been a quick audible to a screen, but alas, you'll take the run play.
This time a designed run cuts up the field, and a short gain there, maybe 2 yards. That was McHugh.
It's interesting that we've taken this long to see a McHugh-designed run, because he's had 17 rushing attempts in both week one and week two. Really have not had him get going on the ground. Granted, most of the work has been done by Fischetti because, you know, he's been the successful running back so far. But when your quarterback can run, it causes Tufts to bring another guy into the box to spy him and make sure that he's not going to go anywhere, and it opens up your passing lanes.
His running through the first 2 weeks hasn't been the most efficient. Maybe you want to take some pressure off of their freshman quarterback. He's got a man deep downfield looking for him, and that ball is intercepted by Lewis Timmons. Makes a great play on the ball on a shot downfield. He was looking for Holden Gehring, but Timmons steps in and forces the turnover, a huge play for the Jumbos.
Yeah, that's his second interception on the season. Lewis Timmons had a pick last week, too. Huge big play guy on defense. And these Jumbos led the league last year in interceptions. And we talked prior to the game, when you're Williams, you got to limit turnovers. If you're a rookie quarterback, you can't be throwing turnovers like that. It's going to get in your head. You don't want to be down and out. And, you know, I just mentioned to you, they got to set him up with some pitch and catches. You don't got to go deep for the 40-yard bomb every time. It's really hard to make those throws. He underthrew it, and, I mean, he had his receiver, but
Timmons goes up and takes that. The all-NESCAC performer, Lewis Timmons, out of Milton, Massachusetts, has been one of the biggest parts of this defense for several years now, and he makes a play right there. Jumbos take back over at the 30-yard line. Berluti hands that one up to Reese, who bounces it outside and will be taken down at around the 35-yard line. Excuse me, that was Khalid Calhoun, not Chartellus Reese. So moving some guys in and out at the running back position, first break that Reese has really gotten so far.
Yeah, you mentioned Lewis Timmons is from Milton, Mass. Quarterback, Williams quarterback, Owen McHugh is also from Milton, Mass. I wonder if there's been a little bit of a, I don't know, maybe they're friendly or have played together prior to this first meeting.
Excuse me, that might have been Chartellus Reese on that carry. But Reese remains in the game now. Berluti hands the ball off, and that ball is put on the ground, fumbled. And it is recovered, unclear at the moment. Williams calls for it. That was Khalid Calhoun, running the ball. He put the ball on the ground immediately, but recovered by the Jumbos. It looks like they will continue to remain in control of the football. That was not a good fumble from Calhoun. Looks like he just lost his grip on the ball, and he comes off the field.
Well, when you get fewer, like when you're the second running back or the third running back and you come in for snaps, you're just less comfortable with the quarterback in the mesh point. That's a read option play right there. It was a give all the way, and I think he just really never had control of the ball when it was in his chest.
And now they come out in an empty set on third and five. We saw them do this last drive. It was a quarterback draw from Berluti, but he has five wide receivers split out wide. Plenty of weapons to look out. Richardson to his right. He's looking that way. He's going to run it. Exact same thing we saw on the last drive. Berluti cuts it back up the left side of the field and is dragged down at around the 54-yard line. So split those guys out wide. Send them down. There's no one in the middle of the field, and Berluti gets the first down.
Exactly, Jared. You're spot on. And also, when you overrush from the edge like that, you have your two defensive ends, and they're crashing upfield. Berluti just steps right up in the pocket and takes off through the B gap and escapes for a huge pickup. You have no one spying his coverage. Berluti is a known runner. Last week he had a long run of 60-plus yards for a touchdown. You know he's going to take off. So I'm not understanding where, when they go empty, you have to keep someone in the middle of the field as a spy. And a spy is just someone who looks and watches over the quarterback and his sole purpose is to protect the run.
You have to assume the next time they go in an empty look that Williams will make an adjustment, but they didn't that time. Berluti again looking to pass, drives that ball to Fleckner, but off of his hands and incomplete. Yeah. He put some mustard on that one, and Fleckner couldn't bring it in.
Yeah, that could just be a little inexperience from the center fielder. I'm not sure if the transition, maybe, but that one, you just got to look it into your body. It's above your head. Strong hands, but good throw, good route by Fleckner. Come back. I would look to them to come back to the exact same play coming up, and I'm sure they'll complete it.
I could be wrong, but I think he might be an infielder. I'm not sure. I need to watch more Tufts baseball.
Yeah, me too. I've watched absolutely none. But
either way, he's been getting open. Couldn't make the play right there. This time Berluti hands the ball off to Reese, but he tries to make a play where there is none. Cuts it back to the 45. Lost some yards on that play. So that'll set them back. It'll be third and long for the Jumbos.
Yeah, a lot of respect for Reese trying to uphold the play for as long as he did, but there were seven EIFS defenders right in his face the whole time, really nowhere to go, and not a lot of brown jerseys out there in front of them.
Defensive line of Williams has been getting some push. C.J. Vilfort in the middle, number 95. Calvin Jackson, number 97 on the end. They really like to have three guys down there, bring in a fourth linebacker to rush the passer, but as you can see, three guys rushing the passer right now. One of them, Anderson, gets around the edge. Berluti looks to run, points out a blocker. He'll gain around 6 yards, short of the first down. That was Calvin Jackson who came around the edge and really blew up that play for the Jumbos.
Yeah, good run, good scramble from Berluti, but he had Cade Moore on a deep crosser. It was like a 15-yard drag. Kept his eyes up when he was running. I thought he was going to hit him. Cade Moore had both his hands up, but never let go of the ball. And now, when it's in long distance like that, you got to throw the ball. You're not going to run for 20 yards most of the time. So now you're forced to punt.
Yeah, I think Berluti felt the heat. Felt like he had to tuck it and run. You're right, he kept his eyes upfield. This punt from Walsh is high and fair, caught inside the 5-yard line. So a great punt from Walsh. 1:33 left here in the first half, and it will be a long drive for Williams if they want to even up the score before the end of the first half.
Yeah, interesting choice to fair catch the ball within your own five. I think if you
could have let it go.
Let that go, it's going out the back of the end zone. That's another, you know, semi-special teams mistake from Williams. You had the flag earlier on the kickoff, and now you're stuck. Your offense is stuck within your own five against a very solid Jumbos defense.
You're absolutely right. Jumbos have looked strong so far. Last drive was punctuated by an interception from Lewis Timmons. See if the attack changes from Williams here. Probably will look to run the ball, get out of the shadow of their own end zone. Immediately handed off and blown up on the play. Of course, that was Edward U. Terry, the defensive tackle, making a huge play and a loss of one for Williams on the play.
Yeah, U. Terry with a sack and 1.5 tackles for loss on the season. Add another tackle for loss right there. This is going to be tough for Williams to get out of their own side. You have to run the ball, really. You can't afford another turnover through the air. So you got to rely on Fischetti and McHugh to do something on the ground. But it's a dire situation for Williams with a minute 24 left.
You're absolutely right. Tufts takes a timeout right here, so maybe hoping to get the ball back after this possession. But you're right. Kind of have to run the ball within your 5-yard line. If you're Tufts, you know they have to run the ball, and that sets up a bit of a matchup right there. Of course, earlier today, that worked out for Williams in a 61-yard run from Fischetti. But right now, Jumbo's defensive line looking stout with 1:24 left to go before the end of the first half. McHugh back out at quarterback, Fischetti to his left. Press coverage by the cornerbacks out wide. Will be a handoff up the middle to Fischetti. He makes a cut and driven down to the ground, maybe a gain of two. A little bit of a push and pull going on right there in the defensive backfield, but won't be a huge gain and sets up third and long.
Yeah, Tufts is sitting in a cover two man look, it seems, with both their safeties sort of in two deep zones. They're covering half the field. But they have two safeties over the top in case anything breaks through in the run. They're a little light up front, but this seems to be working for them. They're protecting against the pass, too, because now it's 3rd and 7. I wouldn't be surprised if Tufts goes back to their cover one man or cover two man. You like man when your opponent's jammed up in the end zone like this.
Yep, so 3rd and 6 with the ball on the 10-yard line. Jumbos used another timeout, so clearly planning to try to push the ball downfield if they can get a stop here on 3rd and 6. And look who it is. It is the quarterback, Jack Dickinson, back in the game for this 3rd and 6. You have to wonder, they do not want to give Tufts the ball back right now. Could it be a pass play?
Well, they have 7 linemen again with the backup quarterback in. I'm very curious to see if they throw out of this set. Only 2 wide receivers on the field and a tight end.
Reiner feigns a blitz and backs up. And it is a designed run from Dickinson, and it is immediately blown up at the line of scrimmage. Huge play. That was Will Duncanson in on the tackle for the Jumbos, and it will be 4th down.
Yeah, in my opinion, there's just a lot of things wrong with that play call right there. Number one, you take the ball out of your starting quarterback's hands. You know, if you trust that guy to lead your team, why are you taking him out on a 3rd and long situation when you need a play? Second off, you've put that quarterback now in the game four times, and all four times he's rushed out of the same seven linemen front. Do you expect Tufts to not play against the run?
I think you're hoping to break off a long one at some point, even if Tufts stacks against the run. Clearly has not worked so far. They're going to continue to try at it. Dickinson couldn't get the first down there. Fourth and four, the punt team is out on the field. Tufts kicker Vaughn Selick is practicing his field goals on the sideline. Hopefully, if you're Jay Civetti, you can get in a field goal range at least a minute and 12 seconds to work with before this punt. Andre Smith back to return by himself. And a short field, possibly, punting from the four-yard line. Don't want to make a mistake. Look how many guys are lined up on the line right now.
Yeah, Tim Brown has quite the leg, though, every time he's had a nice spiral.
That one is a low punt. It's going to bounce, and not the friendliest bounce for the Jumbos, but rolls past the 45-yard line. Looks like it'll be at the 46-yard line.
Yeah, I mean, you're only 15 yards out of Vaughn Selick's range. We saw him in warm-ups. He was hitting him from 40 yards, so on the 30-yard line. I can't imagine it would be a huge success if Williams was able to stop the Jumbos from picking up 15 yards on this drive. 59 seconds, though, with now, I believe, only with zero timeouts.
Yeah, no timeouts.
So look for a lot of hurry up and a lot of quick game. Interesting note, though, Andre Smith is now in the game at running back. Usually a passing set with him in there. He's a lot of speed.
For sure, and he's a playmaker with the ball in his hands. Haven't seen him too much on offense this year, but a guy who has been on the roster for several years. He's made plays as Berluti takes the snap, looks to pass. Anderson comes around the edge. That ball is caught by Fleckner, and he's blown up on the play by James Hemmer. Did he get out of bounds? He did not. The clock is going to continue to run. Sorry, it was Jackson coming around the edge, not Anderson. Excuse me.
Yeah, that's really unfortunate
and
there
a flag flies.
For the Jumbos, though, to not get out of bounds. You got to know the situation with under a minute left. You got to get out of bounds.
Yeah, he tried to, but a big tackle from Hemmer prevented him, and now a false start will move the Jumbos back. Not sure the rules regarding a runoff. The clock was running, called for the false start. They will replay, So there you go. Answered my question. 10-second runoff. Under a minute, 2 minutes, with the clock running. So 29 seconds on the clock, and that was not a great series of events for the Jumbos.
Not at all. Now you're in second and long. Passing situation. 29 seconds, clock's running.
Berluti immediately pressured, looking to throw, keeping his eyes upfield, cuts and gains some yards back to where they started this drive. He's going to try to rush up to the line, but the clock is running. We are under 15 seconds here in the first half. He might try to spike this, and he will.
Berluti's got to be smarter than that. You know the clock's under 30 seconds now. You're running with the ball.
Get rid of it.
You throw the ball away, one. Two, if you're going to run the ball, get out of bounds. And three, take a shot downfield. You had Cade Moore on a go route, beat his man. He's looking downfield. He pulled the ball out to fake the throw so he can run. But if you're going to run ever with under a minute left, get out of bounds.
Yeah, looking to not make mistakes right there. Didn't want to try to force one. Now, you know, fourth down and seven, they're just going to try to get it to prevent defense here from Williams. Berluti's got plenty of time. He's going to launch this one towards the end zone. That ball is in the air forever, and it is almost caught, but incomplete. That was Richardson. Who tried to make a play. He came up with the ball, but no dice right there. Incomplete. And that brings us to the end of the first half. 14-7 is the score here at the Ellis Oval as we enter into halftime. My name is Jared Cohen, joined by Henry Burns. We will be back in a little bit.
so hypnotic, magical.
Well, a back-to-back and forth and back and forth we went in that first half between Tufts and Williams. Score at halftime reading 14 Tufts, 7 in favor of the Eaves. Welcome, everybody, to the Jumbo Zone where we've got halftime coverage. My name is Andrew Howe. I'm joined alongside Riley Daniel. We saw a lot of good things for both of those teams in that first half. Riley, what stuck out to you most?
Yeah, I mean, I think for the Jumbos, what impressed me most was really Michael Baruti's connection with Jaden Richardson. They hit on a couple deep balls, including that touchdown, which we'll get to in a minute. And then for the Eaves, you got to talk about the run game. I mean, just looking at their rushing yards here, that's 124 rushing yards on only 50 attempts. So super, super efficient in the running game today.
You can see some of those big plays, both the passing touchdown picked up by McHugh and then the interception by Lewis Timmons, which really turned the tide around in this game, made sure that we are still sitting here at 14-7. You can see the team comparison down the line. Tufts doing a good job both on the run and passing. Same can be said right now for the Williams Eaves.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think if you're the Jumbos, you're happy going to the break up 14-7, but at the same time, you might wonder, should you be up a little bit more with some of those chances? I mean, you think about the 4th-and-1 and the decision to punt it at midfield. Maybe you be more aggressive, you walk away with points there.
Yeah. Well, they have the lead for now, and a large part of that comes based off of one specific receiver, and that is number 5 for the Tufts Jumbos in Jaden Richardson. A crazy play to pick up that touchdown for himself. Right all the way down in the back of the end zone. I think we got that replay ready for you in just a little bit. But overall, Jaden Richardson and all of the Tufts receivers have had really solid games. Berluti making sure to use many of his options in order to keep that ball moving.
Yeah, I think I was counting. I think 6 different receivers had catches in that first half. And he's surprisingly quiet from Cade Moore, who only had 1 catch in that first half. If you can get yourself a lead at halftime with who was arguably your best receiver in the first 2 games and Cade Moore only having 1 catch, you got to be feeling pretty good about the offense.
Yeah, I mean, overall right now, Richardson, who was the main target for Berluti in the first game that they played, didn't have a ton of attention in the second, but today definitely has been targeted 7 times, a multitude of instances where he was just this shy of coming away with another miracle reception, and of course, that 1 passing touchdown. Not just the pass has been important for both of these teams. Also have to take a look at that featured matchup, which we alluded to at the start of our coverage today. Chartelis Reese and Mario Fischetti both having very solid games.
Yeah, I mean, Fischetti, 111 yards in only 13 attempts. On the other side, you got Chartelis Reese with 73 yards there as we take a look at some of these highlights from the first half.
Yeah, I mean, Fischetti had a couple of really big runs that have brought his numbers up miraculously. A couple of them nearly resulting in touchdowns. I believe this is one of them that you see right here. Just finding that pocket and just going all the way. Good job on the Tufts defense to stop that, but Fischetti really has been a big focal point of the Williams offense so far today.
Yeah, I mean, I think I wouldn't even say big. I'd say the focal point. If the Jumbos defense can find a way to shut him down, they should be able to shut down the rest of Williams' offense.
Take a look at the head-to-head here. A big matchup that we alluded to and so far has been kind of the biggest thing on our minds throughout the first half, and we'll see if it continues to be a factor as we head into the second. Before we take a short break here on the Jumbo Zone, let's take a look around the NESCAC to see what the other teams in our conference have been doing. Right off the bat, you mentioned Trinity being a big factor, you know, winning their first 2 games. They are down right now to Amherst big.
Yeah, I mean, that I almost had to check my eyesight when I saw that score. 42-0 in favor of Amherst is honestly, there's no other word than shocking.
Yeah, down the line as well, we have Bowdoin and Middlebury going at it, Wesleyan up on Hamilton, and later tonight, Colby versus Bates. We can also take a look at what the Jumbos have been doing on other fields for this weekend as well. You see the volleyball team currently down 1-0 against Hamilton. They also lost the other day to Middlebury. That's a team that is looking to find their footing as they head into the rest of the season. And in soccer, Riley, which I know you're a big expert in.
Yeah, I mean, they had that game up in Colby earlier this afternoon, had the lead going in late, gave up a tying goal for the second weekend in a row with 10 minutes to go, and walked away with a 1-1 draw. And then, of course, you have men's soccer, who just kicked off against Colby. So, and we can we're gonna correct a previous statement. It was an error on our part. It's actually 42-0 in favor of Trinity.
You know, that makes a little bit more sense.
Yeah, I feel like that one kind of jives with expectations a bit more.
Yeah, that lines up a little bit more. Of course, we'll cover all of the rest of Tough Sports. But that's going to do it for us for just a little bit, stepping aside on the Jumbo Zone before we have Riley Daniel sitting down with Tufts basketball superstar, Callie O'Brien.
Good. All right, Callie. Hello and welcome back to the Jumbo Zone live from Ellis Oval. I'm Riley Daniel and I am privileged to be here for a halftime sit down with Jumbo's women's basketball captain and star guard, Callie O'Brien. First of all, welcome. It's great
Thank
to have you, Callie. I have to ask you now, as a senior here on campus, is there an extra weight to every game you're at, knowing this is your last homecoming, your last Williams home game, next football game will be the last parents' weekend?
I wouldn't necessarily call it an extra weight. I think it's honestly great to kind of get to enjoy the moment, knowing that this is the last of everything we're going to do. It makes you really take everything in and enjoy all the little things and the time that we have left with everybody.
Yeah, I was looking at the calendar this morning, and I got excited. It's less than 6 weeks now till the start of the season. 6 weeks from tomorrow will be the home opener against St. John's Fisher on JumboCast. So I got to ask, how is the preseason going? Is there any extra expectations after being only a couple points away from the Final Four last year?
Yeah, I think we definitely have high expectations. I think we're all looking forward to going into this season with a lot more experience than we started last season, too. We're lucky to have a lot of the same team we had last year, and everyone kind of got to get a feel for that high-stakes game and what it takes to get there. And I think we're ready to kind of start right where we left off.
Awesome. So I think one thing that's become increasingly apparent over the course of the fall is that we can maybe argue the biggest fans of Jumbo sports teams are the other Jumbo sports teams. I mean, we've seen an impressive attendance record from the women's basketball team. We've seen them at volleyball games, at women's soccer, at men's soccer, now here at football, all in the last 2 weeks. Can you speak a little to the connection between the sports teams here on campus?
Yes, I think it's awesome. I mean, we all love going to see each other's games. Like, so far, I think we've been to every home volleyball game, and I get so excited just to be there and get to watch some of my best friends and also just watch a great game. And I think it speaks to how tight-knit of a athletics community we have here, which is a great thing. I think it's something not everyone gets to experience, so I'm grateful for that.
All right, I got one last question for you, Callie. So obviously we are the Jumbos, and we have coming on screen here a video of you, the captain of the Jumbos, getting to meet a Jumbo elephant for the first time. Can you walk us through that moment?
Oh my gosh, it was so cool. We actually, everyone knows Annika, my fellow backcourt buddy. She is now lives in Thailand, so we all got to visit her this summer and see real elephants. It was incredible. I think it also prepared us. Now we really got to feel what it is to be a Jumbo. We're going to take that into the season.
So a Jumbo mentality
exactly,
going into the season.
Exactly, exactly, yes.
All right, with that, we will take a short break. When we come back, it'll be Jared and Henry with the second half.
Woo!
Here at the Ellis Oval, 14-7, Tufts is the score, and Williams, excuse me, will take over as we are here at the second half. Williams versus Tufts, and an eventful first half it was. Long run from Mario Fischetti of the Williams Eves, responded to by a beautiful one-handed touchdown from Jaden Richardson. We've seen some back and forth, and now Williams has an opportunity to come down the field and tie the game as we enter the second half. First play unsurprisingly, a handoff to Fischetti. He is met and dropped after a gain of around five, a good chunk on first down for Fischetti.
Yeah, we were talking at halftime about Fischetti. His long run of 61 yards makes up 42% of the total Williams offense. So you take that away, and they're looking at sub 100 yards on the day.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Again, Fischetti has been the focal point of their offense and has been productive, but that one play really changed the game for them. They've been, they've struggled to really pick up huge gains, chunk plays. Outside of that, here they are, third down and six. They are 0-5 on third down this far into the game, still without a conversion. So this is a play, if you're Williams, you're really looking, we need a spark, let's convert. Third down, two men in the backfield. McHugh, man in motion. He's going to hand it off to Fischetti. Cuts up field, a nice chunk, but it looks like he's going to be short. So conservative play calling from Williams, and it does not end in a first down. Fourth and one, and out comes the punt team.
Yeah, you said it right there, conservative play calling. The run game almost seems to be the crutch for this Williams team. They can't get away from it. I understand relying on what you're good at, and I know this is where they've seen success in the past weeks. But let your quarterback throw the ball. That's what he's out there to do. That's what you recruit him to do. You recruit him to throw the ball.
And, you know, we watched some of their game film, and we've seen he can throw the ball. He has a good arm. He can make accurate throws over the middle of the field. He's threaded some needles. I think maybe it's a matchup thing against Tufts. They really want to exploit their advantage in the run game. But at some point, got to let McHugh get back there and sling it as they punt the ball away. That one is another long punt. It's been a good game in the punting field for Williams. They have managed to pin Tufts back a couple times, but this time the ball out at the 23-yard line, and the Jumbos will take over.
Yeah, it's been really total domination so far for Tufts offense. Reese averaging 5.5 yards a carry. We talked before the game, oh, is the 8 yards per carry sustainable? No, but 5.5 yards is extremely successful as a running back.
Yeah, and they've been productive runs, too, and a couple for negative gains that, you know, impacted their ability as we see Jumbos again flip the field with the offensive line, hand off to Reese, a big hole, and he cuts up the middle, puts his head down, and gets close to a first down. They've had success when moving their offensive lineman and taking advantage of what the defense is giving them.
Yeah, it looked like Chartellus Reese got hit right in the head there. I don't know if that was helmet-to-helmet or shoulder-to-helmet, but he came up a little lame after that play.
Yeah, he's going to come off the field.
Jaden Richardson gave him a little shot right to the head after that, after getting hit in the head. But
No worries.
Interesting to see when Tufts shifts those linemen over, they've been running behind him the whole time.
So Khalid Calhoun back in the game, he did fumble on his first attempt earlier, but with Reese on the sideline, he will be in the backfield. Another jumbo offensive line set, two wide receivers split out wide. Berluti does hand the ball off to Calhoun, and he makes a play quick up the middle through the hole and a gain of around six. So Calhoun fumbled his first carry, but not this time. A little read option. The communication was right on, and they get a good gain.
Yeah, good to see him getting in his rhythm, because when your bell cow goes down or when your bell cow needs a break, you need a solid backup to come in. Awesome to see that the connection, the mesh point is back on track. Sometimes I remember at halftime you do a little mesh in the locker room. Do walk it through a couple times, especially after a fumble like that.
So Kent Oliver in as an extra offensive lineman. Him and Gus Bickert move to the left. Berluti motions his running back over and calls a timeout. So didn't like what he saw, apparently, the defensive look right there. Did you see anything notable?
I'm not sure. Maybe they had I'm not sure the exact play call they had designed up there, but I like the run play to the left. When they shifted the two linemen over to the left side, nobody flipped on the Williams defense. They had the stand-up linebacker on the far right side. It was number seven again.
Ethan Scott.
They've had him coming off the edge all day. And personally, I like two big offensive linemen on a stand-up linebacker. You neutralize him right away, and then you run to the same side. I mean, you saw them flip the running back to the left side. It seemed like they were going to intend to do a straight
counter,
dive.
Yeah.
I don't know. But Berluti didn't like what he saw, so good on him to take a timeout. However, now they're only down to two timeouts.
Yeah, you would like to avoid that if you can, but presumably, and now they come out and again shift their offensive linemen over, Oliver and Bickert, see if they run in their direction. Berluti will hand it off right up the middle. Calhoun, and he will pick up a first down.
I'm curious if so you saw them come out with the same, essentially the same play again, where they motioned the two linemen. But I'm curious if the reason Berluti called the timeout is because he motioned the two linemen into the side with the stand-up linebacker. Williams came out with the same defensive personnel, the same set, kept the linebacker on Tufts' left side, and essentially Civetti and Berluti flipped the play and ran to the other side.
Yeah, now Reese has re-entered the game, so it looks like he's fine after getting a little shook up. Now first and 10 from the 44-yard line. Same look we've been seeing. Oliver in as a tight end or extra offensive lineman, and that one is a play action pass over the middle of the field, popped up in the air and almost intercepted. That was intended for Jaden Richardson. Couldn't hook up with him, and very, very close to a disastrous play for the Jumbos.
Yeah, Tufts got lucky with the bounce there. There was four Williams DBs surrounding, hawking for that ball when it came out of Richardson's hands, but somehow hit the turf. Interesting to see Tufts pass out of this heavy look, because you know there are two pseudo tight ends that are in there, the big guys. They're not going to go out for a route, so you effectively have two wide receivers. It's going to either Richardson or Moore.
And Williams didn't bite too hard on the run right there, so play action, and that could have been completed, but a tough throw over the middle of the field. This time, no play action. Berluti looks down the right side, in between three men, jumping and making the grab is Jaden Richardson. He found a soft spot in the zone, it looked like, and he caught it and brought it in for the first down.
Yeah, absolutely, Jared. The corner in the cover three is supposed to take over the top on that deep third, and Richardson sort of got right in front of him and stopped down.
Looks like C.J. Vilfort, the defensive tackle for Williams, has come up a bit lame after that play. So we will have a little bit of a break right here. But on that throw, Berluti really doing what he does best, which is finding holes in the defense. And, you know, he can throw with some velocity. He did it right there. He just is such a well-rounded quarterback for the Jumbos. He can run. He makes smart reads, doesn't turn the ball over too often. And honestly, they ran up the score a lot last week in a big game, but so what he's doing so far today is really what you want to see from him. His completion percentage coming in today was under 50%. It's going to be well over that by the time this game is over, and they've been balancing all three aspects of their game pretty well. I think but they're happy with what they've been doing so far. Williams really is on their heels right now.
Yeah, I think you're happy being up 14-7, but like I said earlier, you're not satisfied, because the way the Tufts have been playing, they've been playing strong. They've been clearly the dominant team, but they just don't have enough points to show for it at this moment. So converting on this drive is huge, going up 21-7. It'll be interesting to see if C.J. Vilfort can come back into the game, because he's a huge presence on their defensive line. And they rely heavily on that three defensive linemen front. And if you lose one of your big guys, now you have a hole that's got to be filled by someone coming in off the bench who is not as successful as your guy.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. They have a consistent three guys who are on that line. Jackson, Vilfort, and Cameron Smith, they are out there pretty much every play. As you said, they run three guys on the defensive line. You lose Vilfort, and that is a big deal in terms of the pressure they can generate up the middle. So see how they adjust. Smith is still out there, and Ethan Scott looking creeping up as an extra pass rusher. Reed still in the game at running back. Berluti is going to keep that one. Rush up the middle. He's got a ton of room. Makes one man miss. A good tackle from Austin Demmel, but a first down from Berluti. Made the right choice on that option play.
Yeah, the rushing DN there flew way upfield, and the inside pull read was totally there. And I mentioned it earlier, though, that's what I wanted to see, is Tufts exposing the free safety in the middle of the cover three. Demmel made a huge play. Stopped touchdown-saving tackle. Really got at his legs, but fantastic play by Berluti. Great read.
He has deceptive speed, really. Once he gets to that second level of the defense, defenders seem to just completely miss him. Good tackle right there. This time Berluti's looking towards the end zone. He's got Richardson wide open, and he has another touchdown. Jaden Richardson from Michael Berluti. Well done right there, and the lead has been extended 20-7. Easy pitch and catch.
Yeah, love the post route. Found the hole right in between the safety and the corner. Ran right up. That's a smart play by Jaden Richardson. Knew where the hole would be in the defense, and Berluti dialed him up. That's that big playability between Berluti and Jaden Richardson we've seen all season. We saw last year, too. That's their specialty, the big play.
And Richardson, a guy, as we said, who can really stretch the field. And even when you're in a closer situation within the 50-yard line in the red zone, it's so hard to cover him in space that if you can get him over the middle of the field, you got to have two guys back there, or else he's going to make them pay. He did right there. Field goal. extra point is up and good. So 21-7. As I said, Tufts probably a little happier right now. They could come out and put some points on the board. Williams needs to get something going through the air if they want a chance to get back in this. So they'll take over in just a minute. So we are back here, 10 minutes and 14 seconds left to go in the third quarter. Crowd with a reaction to the news that Amherst is losing to Trinity 49-0 at the moment. So a big score from Trinity, who has been dominating their way through the NESCAC through 3 weeks. Crowd with a real reaction from that one. Trinity put 44 on Tufts week one, and this is their third straight game with 40 points. They're looking like the team to beat in the NESCAC so far.
This is statement season from Trinity. It looks like they're going to be pushed into some national rankings.
As the kickoff called for fair catch, and fair catch indeed. That was John Orris, the running back, calling for it, and Williams desperately in need of some offense right here.
Yeah, I don't think I was mentioning this to Jared over the halftime, is they haven't set up their freshman quarterback with a lot of easy pitch and catches. I mentioned it before, and then they threw the long ball for the interception. I love going aggressive sometimes, but set up the long ball by using your quick game. Your quarterback has a strong arm, so use it.
You can see Berluti on the sideline hyping up the Tufts team, giving a little talk. Offense is meeting right now. Have to be happy with the results, but not ready to give up. Want more. Now Williams back. McHugh in at quarterback. Man in motion. He does go play action, and they're looking deep, and he has a man wide open, and that ball is caught for a long completion, complete to Brady Stalski, the freshman wide receiver. He makes a huge play. There was nobody back there, and Tufts cannot stop Williams on the first play after they score a touchdown.
Well, I'll eat crow, I guess. I keep telling them to go short, and they're going to keep going long right over top. That's the exact same play they threw a pick on earlier. I like to see him coming back to it because when that pick happened, you know, Jared and I both said he had him. He had a step on Timmons, and he goes right back to the same play. Good on the coach for recognizing that play worked.
Yeah, so a huge play to start off the drive. Now they go play action yet again. They have another man open down the middle of the field. He's going to look there, one-on-one action, and incomplete. Looked like a little early contact there, but no call. He was looking for I'm not sure who he was looking for right there. That was Sam Jaffe. First target for him today, and fell incomplete, but back-to-back play action shots to start this drive.
Looked like a simple seam route from the tight end there, and nobody was on him.
He could have hit him earlier.
McHugh really held on to the ball way too long.
So some defensive miscues so far. This time he does hand it off, and it is Fischetti who cuts it back. He's got plenty of room if he can get to the edge. Great vision from Fischetti. He breaks it outside again past the 20-yard line. He's inside the 15. What a run from Fischetti. Really using the vision to cut that one back.
Yeah, fantastic vision to realize you can reverse the field and there are no numbers on the right side. But I love to shout out the quarterback, doing a little Tom Brady impression, running down the field, blocking for your running back, getting out in front of him. He took two defenders and continued the run for Fischetti.
So it looks like a different Williams offense to start off this drive. Long completion. Then a long run, another shot down the field, and now they're in the red zone and threatening to bring this game back within one score. This time a play action fake. He's looking on the fade route. That ball is almost intercepted. It was tipped up in the air. Looked like the receiver, Harshbarger, kind of gave up on the ball and almost led to an interception.
Yeah, it looked like he had some trouble with his footing when he was running that little fade route and fell over and couldn't quite get his hands on it. He had a step on him, though. He was open. I like the aggressive play call going for the end zone on 1st and 10. Would not be shocked to see them go back to the run, though.
And that long completion to Brady Stileski was for 43 yards. So not quite as long as that run we saw earlier, but easily the longest play through the air of the day. This time it's a designed run going nowhere. Gang tackle led by the Jumbos right there.
Yeah, that's really like the second designed quarterback run we've seen today. True design run, no, not scrambling for Owen McHugh. It wasn't super successful on that play, but I like that they keep him in the game doing the design QB runs and not subbing in a separate quarterback, because it still confuses the defense, thinking that the pass is still an option.
I agree. Leaves some unpredictability out there, which you kind of throw away when you bring in Dickinson. That was Comerford in on the tackle, among others. McHugh remains in the game with Fischetti in the backfield. Third and nine. McHugh drops back to pass, and the play is whistled dead. And it will be on the offense. It looks like a false start. So third and nine will be third and 14.
Going to be interested to see if Williams comes back to the same play that they just put out there. It was a tight bunch to the right, and they had one receiver to the left. Immediately, right as the ball was snapped, McHugh had his head fully turned to the left, wasn't even looking to the bunch on the right. Looks like he likes that one-on-one matchup on the left side. Be curious to go back. I believe that they have Lewis Timmons is the one that he's going to try to take advantage of on the left side.
So third and 14, under 8 minutes now in the third quarter. Score remains 21-7. Big third down right here, probably a shot to the end zone. McHugh has a man but cannot find him. Incomplete on the left side of the end zone. That was Bryce Cooper. He beat his man but just a little bit out of his reach.
Yeah, not getting a lot of help here from his receivers at the moment right now. That was, it looks like it went right between his hands.
Yeah, maybe want to get a little more air on that, but yeah. He beat the man, he put it on him, and he couldn't make the catch, so the field goal unit will come out. This is Ivan Charon. He's been one of the better kickers in the NESCAC in recent years.
Yeah, I think his career long is close to 44 yards, so this
correct.
Is well within his range.
That one is up, and it is good. So he connects on the field goal and brings the score 21-10. Getting some points back, definitely what Williams wanted right there. They had a big play through the air and almost got it into the end zone several times, but came up just short, and the ball will go back to Tufts.
Yeah, that's almost a positive defensive stop, though, from Tufts. I know you put up three on the board, but you're still up 11. You're getting the ball back. You got a chance to score. I mean, at the minimum, you go down and you kick a field goal, and it's still a two-possession game. So regardless, Williams needs to get the ball back twice to even come within Tufts.
Yeah, you have to think, if that wasn't such a long third down, if it was a third and short, that's probably four down territory. Field goal helps a little bit, doesn't help a lot. As you said, still a two-score game.
Yeah, that's like kind of putting a Band-Aid on an arterial bleed. I'm not really sure if that's going to help too much. But
EMT talk from Henry Burns. Return team back out. Jayshon Means and Andre Smith for the Jumbos.
It's worth noting that Williams has had no turnovers today, forced no turnovers on defense. Tufts put the ball on the turf once earlier, but
and
Williams
somehow
was not able
to come up with it.
That would be huge for Williams to get a turnover right now. Then you go on to score a touchdown, and now you're only down four. But if you're Tufts, you want to milk the clock on this drive. I would not be surprised to see a lot of running the ball.
Aside from that fumble by Calhoun, the backup, Berluti hasn't really put the ball in harm's way, so it's been a solid performance. That ball on the turf and picked up by Smith, so he'll have the ball at around the 18-yard line. Good decision to fall on it right there. A little bit risky.
Yeah, you talk about putting the ball in harm's way is letting the ball bounce on a kickoff. That's a live ball all day. That's a fumble rolling around. Good to jump on it, but now Tufts is starting within their own 21, inside their own 20. So
probably could have looked for a fair catch right there.
Definitely.
Did not do it. But 19-yard line is where the ball will be spotted. 7 minutes, 42 seconds to go here in the third quarter. Moving a little bit slowly, but the Jumbos retake possession on offense. Reese in the backfield. Two receivers split out wide. Extra offensive lineman in the game for Tufts. Berluti hands the ball off on first down to Reese, looking for the edge. He is lit up and stopped short of the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, great tackle for loss there by Williams. Penetrating through the line, getting in the backfield, making big plays, gang tackling, rallying to the ball. Those are huge defensive terms that I'm sure they hammer home in practice all week.
They were not fooled on that one by the outside run or the thought of a option from Berluti. So now second and 14, a loss of four on that play, sets them back to the 15-yard line. Empty set. We've seen this before.
Yeah.
Interesting look with Fleckner lined up in the slot. This time Berluti looking to pass. He's going to look outside to Fleckner, who catches it and is flipped upside down. Not a huge gain, so we'll come to third and long.
Yeah, that's a nice little play design there, though, splitting one receiver out super far wide. It stretches the corner who's supposed to be in that deep third. Now he's pushed really far to the sideline. Now it puts your safety who's in the middle of the field. He's supposed to roam a really wide range. They had a seam route, but the safety took it away, and then they took the under route with Fleckner.
And that was Papadopoulos in on the tackle. So third and 12, looking through the air most likely here, is Berluti, who takes the snap, steps back to pass, pressured immediately, rolling out to his right. He's going to tuck it and run. He's got room, cuts it back to the middle of the field, and dives for a first down. A huge third down scramble from Berluti, and yet again, he shows what he can do with his legs.
Yeah, and he's doing a great job, though. Whether he knows he's going to run or not, he's still keeping his eyes down the field. He's got the ball cocked like he's going to throw it, and until the last second, he tucks and runs. Interesting decision for him to dive head first, though, to get over the line. I like the aggression, but that's your quarterback. You gotta slide, get down.
Since pretty much his first day as Tufts quarterback, he has consistently kept his eyes upfield when running. Here, they run an option, and he tries to pitch it out. Looked like it could have been a big play to Cade Moore. It was an option into a screen pass, almost, and incomplete for Moore just off his fingertips.
Yeah, a nice RPO with a little bubble screen at what it looked like to Cade Moore. Had space out on the left side, like you said, Jared. If that gets completed, that's at least a 10-yard completion.
Yeah, tough to hook up on that. Moving in his direction, trying to lead him a little bit, and just couldn't get it done. So it'll be second and 10. The Berluti scramble prolonged a drive. Looked like it might have been stalling out. Reese in the backfield. Four receivers out wide. Berluti looks towards the middle, looking for Jaden Richardson, who wants a flag. No flags come in, and it'll be another third and long. Looked like he was blanking it on that one.
Yeah, rightful no call. I think what Jaden Richardson was putting his hands up was he was triple covered. That was not pass interference. He just was not open. Berluti kind of forced it to his guy there. That puts Richardson, I believe, at 11 targets on the day. He's loving the connection, but still only five catches for Richardson so far.
Two of those for touchdowns, of course. But, yeah, would love to see that Phil Lutz-type connection we saw last year where third down after third down find plays over the middle of the field. Another timeout called right here. They want to think it over before third down. That might have been a Williams timeout, excuse me.
Yeah, Williams on a third and long and fourth and long situations has been going to the cover four, sagging off look. It hasn't worked really so far. So I'd like to see them stick with their base cover three shell, which has at least caused some confusion in this Berluti to Richardson connection, so long as they don't get dusted over top again.
What do you think they're coming out looking for right here on third and 10?
If you're Tufts, I think you're looking for these, as they ran earlier, you're looking for dig routes right at the stick. You're probably looking for one guy who's going to get sent on a streak or a go route, and then a guy who's coming underneath on a dig. Once you pull the DB and the safety off of him. So I would look for, you know, either that or maybe a smash concept with like a hitch on the inside, a hitch on the outside or an out on the outside and then a corner from the inside.
Offense retakes the field. Big third down coming up.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't be surprised to see Cade Moore. I think he's in the slot on the left side to run a go route, so it opens it up underneath for the other two.
See if that's what happens. Berluti now drops back to pass, pressured, and looks to run. Looks like a QB draw. Dives head first again for another first down. That one looks set up from the beginning.
Yeah, that was a designed QB run. I think they had everybody fooled, think they were going to go pass. That's, like we've harped on all day, that's what you get when you have a mobile quarterback, a dual threat, a true dual threat.
Really, when he gets in a straight line, he can move and he can make plays. He did it right there. Quickly up to the line, he's going to keep it again. They now run that bubble screen they looked for before, and it'll be a gain of around six, a positive play on the read option bubble screen to Cade Moore.
Yeah, that was a, That was a great tackle by Nate DeLugos on the defensive side. Freshman DB, that's a big tackle. Cade Moore was one-on-one with him. That's a one-on-one tackle as a cornerback. Those are tough plays to make. You're not out there to make tackles. You're out there to defend the pass. So way to step up. But good little pitch and catch. Like to see him going back to the play that they noticed was open.
Yeah, haven't been as many repeated plays that Tufts has gone back to knowing they can just get a couple yards here and there. That looks like one they might have some faith in. Second and six, Berluti hands that one off to Reese, puts his head down, and gains around three or four. Should be third and short.
Yeah, Tufts are establishing quite the drive here, though, with time of possession. They've seen a lot of runs on this script, only a few passes, and the passes they have been short completions that have landed them in bounds. So the clock has been continuously running. Very few incompletions. If you're Williams, you need to stop here on third down. Get your big boys up front. Get a push. Get in the backfield. It's most likely a passing down, especially out of this trips look from Tufts. But
third and four. Indeed, a pass from Berluti. Points out a man. Scrambles out to his left. Throws and completes a pass to Richardson for the first down on the left sideline. Saw something immediately and found his man keeping the play alive.
Yeah, it looked like his initial read wasn't there, and he started to scramble out to the left. You saw him just give a thumbs up to Richardson. That was scramble drill all the way. When your quarterback runs out, you got to come back to your quarterback. You got to find the sideline. You find your connection. Way to tee up a little pitch and catch for the first down right there.
Absolutely. Richardson went with him, and it worked for the first down. Now clock under 4 minutes. You're right. Tufts is keeping this clock rolling and up 11 points. That's what they want to do. Berluti fakes the bubble screen, spin move, and dives again close for a first down. He is making plays so far, and now this is the Jay Civetti offense where you can kind of have variations on things that you've gone to before and really make plays consistently.
Yeah, that's the third time this drive they've gone to the RPO bubble screen. Berluti really just letting his body get out there, though. With a fake pass, you could get lit up on that by a lurking linebacker who wants nothing more than to lay out the opposing team's quarterback. But great spin move.
Quite the spin move.
Yeah.
So second and two. Berluti looking to pass. Steps up. Pressure. Shakes off a man. He's running again, trying to get to the sideline, and he does for the first down. It was Drew Michalik who came in and tried to pressure him, got two hands on him, but Berluti shook him away and gained the first down.
Yeah, that's another first down picked up by Berluti on the ground. I think that's three now on this drive that he's picked up on his own.
So Berluti has been the engine of the Jumbos as usual, but in particular on this drive. Again, passing on first down. Quick throw to Richardson. Slips and will be down short of the first down. But there we go. Really a stark difference in this drive from the rest of the game. They are getting back into their quick offense, yeah, Getting the ball out, and picking up yards on every play.
Right there, it didn't matter what the play call was. He was going to Richardson the whole time. The DB on Richardson was 10, 15 yards back. You know the five-yard hitch is wide open. Richardson's been getting over top of him all day. Clearly Williams has made an adjustment and told him to sag off. But when you sag like that, it's an easy pitch and catch.
Williams defense looking to step up now. They've got veterans in the game. Tim Landolfi at middle linebacker. Second and four. Can they make a play right here? It looks like an option. Berluti keeps it again, this time wrapped up. Landolfi, as mentioned, comes in and makes the play. So they do stand right there, holding Tufts short there, and it will be third down.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a 50-50 read. I'm not sure that the end bit super hard. And as a quarterback, not to throw the running back under the bus, but you like to give the ball off when it's questionable because you don't want to be the one that's taking the big hits like that. You don't like your quarterback getting tackled by four guys.
And here for Tufts is when your offense is moving, but you don't want to verge on being predictable. And, you know, Berluti has clearly been a threat on the ground this drive. Third and four on the 23 with two men split out wide. Here they go back to what they've been doing earlier, moving their offensive lineman over. Could signal a run, but they've got two playmakers on the outside. It is a handoff to Reese, and it looks like he will be close to a first down, maybe a little bit short.
That's a heck of a stop by Williams. They shot the gaps. They sent really the house at that formation. Tufts has passed out of that motion lineman set one time, I think. So good identification by Williams. Way to shoot all the linebackers' pressure, fill the holes. Now it's fourth and short. You're stuck with a tricky situation. It looks like they're going to go for it.
Yeah, they're going to go for it. Earlier this game, they went for it, converted, had it called back because of a penalty, and then decided to punt. So fourth and two here. same formation. Williams is thinking run up the middle. And that is what it's going to be. Reese might be short there. He was tripped up very quickly on the play. It was Drew Michalik yet again, and a turnover on downs for the Jumbos. It's going back in the direction of the Williams Eaves.
That was another two consecutive big stands from the Williams D-line and linebacker core. Shot into the backfield. Someone got at Reese's legs and pulled him down and stopped him dead in his tracks. Heck of a stand. Now you're down 11, 43 seconds left in the third quarter. On the last drive, they open up with a huge deep ball over top. I wouldn't be surprised to see them go back to the same deep looks after establishing a little bit of a run heavy.
So Williams' defense has given them a chance. 11-point game right now. McHugh keeps it on the read option. Tries to cut outside. He's not going to get very much right there.
Yeah, down 11 in the with 40 seconds left in the third quarter, you don't have to abandon the run. You have an entire quarter coming after this one, and you still have time left to run off the clock in this quarter. So I like them starting off with a run. I wouldn't be surprised to see them go back to it on second or third down, but look for at least some sort of pass from the quarterback. It's been working on this Tufts defense.
They're very dependent so far on the big play is what I would say. The 61-yard run, the long pass on the last drive, they have not really been able to pick up chunks here and there through the air. So, yeah, not a bad idea to continue on the ground if that's what's been working for them so far. Play action, they want to take another shot. There's two men right there, and he's tripped up. A flag is going to come out. There were two men in coverage, Christian Rosario and Jeremy Zuniga were there guarding Brady Selesky, who made the big catch on the last drive. Little, you know, feet-to-feet action, got tripped up, and big flag.
Yeah, but with the college rules where it's not a spot foul and you only get a 15-yard penalty, he had them both beat again. I think that's a penalty and one of those where if you're a defensive backs coach or a defensive coordinator, you tell your guys, listen, if you're getting beat like that, you pull them down to the ground, you take the penalty. Give them the 15 yards. It's better than the big shot play.
Stileski is a freshman, 6'4", and 190 pounds out of Palmer, Mass. Two penalties also came flying. There was an offsides and pass interference. They will decline the offsides call and accept the pass interference. But as I was saying, Stileski hadn't really seen much action before today. I don't believe he had a catch. But today, playing a bigger role in the offense, that's a lot of size out there. 6'4", and he looks pretty fast.
He does. He's 6'4", but he's moving. He's been able to get on top of the Tufts defensive backs, and he's been the vertical threat that Jaden Richardson shows for the Tufts offense.
This time a handoff to Fischetti, cuts it outside, tries to make a man miss, but brought down on the play by Christian Rosario, the senior defensive back, makes a great tackle in open space.
Yeah, great job by Rosario. When the Tufts running back starts only working horizontally rather than vertically, you want to see a cut up the field.
And now we have a report from Andrew Howe on the sideline.
Thank you, guys. A big focus coming into today was the rushing from both teams. And while Mario Fischetti certainly has done that for the Eaves, the main rusher for the Jumbos today is none other than their quarterback in Michael Berluti. He has 100 yards on 14 rushes. Meanwhile, of course, Chartellus Reese, who has had a great game, 76 yards on 17 rushes. And this, of course, is no surprise for many who are fans of the Jumbos. In fact, entering today's game, Michael Berluti led the NESCAC in yards per attempt, right above 10. Large part of that, of course, thanks to the 61-yard rushing touchdown they had against Bates. This dual threat of Berluti is a big part of the Tufts offense and going to be a big part of this fourth quarter. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Andrew. Some interesting stuff right there as we enter the fourth quarter. 15 minutes left to go in this one, 21-10. Jumbos out in front, but Williams stepping up on offense and defense, looking to make this one a ball game as we head down the stretch.
Yeah, after that little deep shot there on the last play, wouldn't be surprised to see them return back to the run. They've had a lot of success. Seems like Fischetti's, you know, he's been breaking outside wide. I'd like to see him use the jump cuts and start pounding the rock vertically and be a threat into the second level.
Fischetti up to 14 attempts for 138 yards on the ground today. So 9.9 yards per attempt. The Tufts' ability to stop the run has not been there.
Yeah, but it's worth noting that he had 109 after the first half, and now he's really down. I mean, he's only had about 30 yards in the second half so far after a quarter.
McHugh looking to run now, tucks it and goes and dives forward. Michael Berluti-esque past the first down yard, but there is a flag on the field. We'll see if this one's coming back. It looks like it is as the offense walks their way. It might be a hold.
Yeah, it looked like a holding there. I'm not sure exactly the number, but it was pretty blatant. That's often the problem, though, on QB scrambles. Your offensive linemen, when it's a design pass, they're in pass pro, they're holding their guy, and then as soon as your quarterback runs past you, you start moving, shifting off to the other side, and you end up dragging the defensive lineman down to the ground.
Yeah, I've seen that many times. Saw that earlier today on the Tufts fourth down call. So moved back a little bit. Now second and 21. Stileski out wide, Fischetti at running back. McHugh remains the quarterback for Williams. Four receivers split out, looking to pass. McHugh looks right, deep down the side of the field. He's got Stileski, but incomplete. A little shove there at the end. He wants a flag. That ball was probably not catchable. But again, they're looking down the field for Stileski.
Yeah, that was an uncatchable ball. And it's second and 21. I understand the idea of taking a shot there, but You had your guy holding underneath, holding Gehring underneath on a slant route. He was wide open, and I get it. You want to take all the yards in one play, but
now much more difficult third down. I think is the point there. Third and 21. They didn't pick up anything there, and now Tufts defense looks like they're gonna sit back, two safeties deep, and prevent a big play. McHugh wants to fire it, but it's knocked out of his hand. A strip sack and recovered by the defense. Recovered by Uteri, knocked out on the play by Javier Rios. A fumble and a recovery for the Jumbos, unless it's called an incomplete pass.
Yeah, it looked like an incomplete pass. His arm was coming forward there as he was throwing.
And it is an incomplete pass. I got a little bit ahead of myself. Looked like the ball came out, but the referees do make it clear, incomplete.
Yeah, good old little tuck rule there from the quarterback. But got bailed out, and that was great pressure. Still, Tufts didn't convert the fumble or a sack, but you knocked it out of the quarterback's hand when it's coming forward. Great way to force a punt. Now you're getting the ball back, up 11 in the fourth quarter. Really more time to milk the clock.
Yeah, it looked to me that Rios' arm came down on McHugh and knocked that ball out, but his arm did indeed move forward, and so it will be an incomplete pass. Could have been a huge turn of events right there. I certainly thought it was, but going the other way now with the punt team. So a big stand on third and 21 regardless. And now Tufts will get the ball back and look to kill a lot of clock here in the fourth quarter. That's going to be a high punt and fair caught by Andre Smith at around the 36-yard line. That is where the Tufts offense will take over.
Yeah, if you're Tufts here, your script can be pretty easy. You can run on first down, you can run on second down, and you can run on third down. As long as you're picking up about 2.5, 3 a carry, which Chartelis Reese and Berluti both have been doing all day, I don't think you really got to move away from the run for a while.
It's really about finishing drives, right? They weren't able to do that last time. If they can on this drive, that will likely put the game away.
Yeah, with 15 minutes on the clock, if you score on this play, it'd be pretty far-fetched to see Williams with a rushing attack complete.
That one handed off to Reese. He will cut back up the middle and be brought down after a gain of around 5. So there's your chunk play on first down on the ground. Have to think they'll probably look back that way. The success of Berluti and Reese on the ground today has really opened up a lot of options.
Yeah, for sure. It's also opened up that little bubble screen that you saw to Cade Moore on the last drive, which they went to 3 times. That was still a long drive, and those screens effectively act as run plays because they're short completions, the ball staying in bounds, time still wastes.
Same look offensively. Berluti looks quickly to Richardson and's got him on a quick out route for around 4 yards. They'll be short of the first down, but sets up third and short, and they are moving the sticks. It is a first down for the Jumbos.
Yeah, this is the same matchup with Jaden Richardson against Justice McGrail. He beat McGrail earlier on that deep post route for a touchdown. I have to imagine McGrail's still thinking about it because he's playing so far off him. He's letting these short passes up. Happened on the last drive, too, with the Jaden Richardson hitch play on the left side.
Great name, by the way, Justice McGrail. He's been out wide at corner for most of today's game. Under 14 minutes now, first and 10. Tufts with the ball, hand off to Reese. Cuts out left, but swarmed by Williams defenders. Too many of them to count. And stopped for a short gain, if anything.
Yeah, it's been a long time since we've seen that Tufts rushing attack get stopped in the backfield. Good to see the Williams is still getting pressure up front and breaking through the line. Another negative or neutral play like that would be huge for this Williams defense to get off the field.
Yeah, or force Tufts into a passing situation, which so far there hasn't really been any on this drive. They would obviously love to continue throwing short, pounding the rock. Clock keeps ticking. Berluti, straight drop back, has a wide open Chartellus Reese and hits him. He wants to cut it back up the field and gets around 7 yards on that one. Reese is always looking for the big play. Let himself into some trouble right there, but managed to get a good chunk.
Yeah, I would have liked to see him continue to the outside situations. Berluti likes to take it himself and dive forward for the third down play, but that's a good stop by Williams. You let the receivers go deep, you cover them all, you'll take a running back underneath in the flat.
So now in Williams' territory, motions Andre Smith out to the left. Berluti's going to tuck it and run again, and he easily has the first down. He is just so shifty when he puts his head down, and Berluti has really been carrying the Tufts offense here in the second half. Over 100 rushing yards on the day.
Yeah, and there was that quarterback draw, like I just mentioned. That's what they like to do on the third and short. I like them disguising it, though, sending Andre Smith in the motion outside wide. You drag a linebacker out with him because you have to cover it, otherwise you'll throw it. Berluti sees that. And they, sure enough, they dragged one out there, and he took it right up the middle for the first down.
So Berluti, 20 of 30 for 190 yards, two passing touchdowns to the air, and 15 attempts for 100 yards on the ground. He's been doing it all. This time he's looking to throw a little head fake. He's going deep. He's got a man wide open. Who else but Jaden Richardson caught for the touchdown. Another big play to his big play threat, and the Jumbos extend their lead.
Yeah, that's again on Justice McGrail's head. That's the second deep ball led up to Richardson over him. That was a sweet double move, a little stutter set. McGrail bit on it because why is he biting on it? Because before he's letting up the hitch route. He's letting up the underneath route. He thinks, here's another one. Richardson sells it real well, digs in deep, and then burns him over top for a huge touchdown.
So the third touchdown of the day passing from Berluti and the third receiving touchdown of the day for Jaden Richardson. Their dynamic duo is back in full force after a week off, and quite the statement from the Jumbos offense extending their lead. Extra point pending. It will be up and good. 28-10 is the score, and the Jumbos are looking real good with 11 minutes and 18 seconds left. Now it's up to Williams to put their foot in the ground and really have a response.
Yeah, this is getting shades of Trinity for Tufts. However, this time Tufts is on the positive result of the scoreboard. But Jaden Richardson, week one, had three touchdowns and 146 yards. He's very close to that stat line so far. Wouldn't be surprised to see Tufts get another chance on offense as well, especially if Williams scores on this drive. Look for Tufts to continue to rack up their offensive numbers on their day.
Yeah, I can't see Tufts taking their foot off the gas. I think just in terms of the statement of the state of this team, the morale of this team, how they play, I don't think they're going to give up anytime soon. They want to put more points on the board, but Williams really wants to respond. They were shut out last week. They only have 10 points so far today. You know, they don't want to have a lost season this early. I think, you know, more than a two-score game, going to be tough for them to come back, but still time left on the clock, and they're going to want to really make a stand.
Yeah, but I think it's worth noting, coming off the – there's just a lot of pressure on this Williams team. They went 9-0 two years ago and then had an off year last year, 3-6. They don't want to be going for another 3-6 season. So although this one might be a little bit out of reach, you take a little bit of a moral victory if you come back a little bit.
Yeah, I agree 100%. These games are never really over, and they matter in the context of the season. If they can get a couple late touchdowns here and get some fire going in their offense, it'll be huge. McHugh, 4-for-15, on through the air and an interception and a touchdown, 65 yards. That's 26.7% through the air. That is not going to play long term. So really, if I'm Williams, I'm coming out right now, try to just get some quick hitters, get that completion percentage up, get some rhythm going in the offense.
I agree. I've been talking about it all day, and they haven't wanted to listen to me yet. But I'm going to say it again. I think they need to start up with some quick passes, some short game, hitches, slants, outs, anything. Tufts is playing cover one. Run your short man beaters like slants and hitches and outs. That they're easy to connect on.
So the offense comes back on the field. McHugh will hand it off to Fischetti. Around 3 yards right there. So he continues to be the bell cow of this offense. Oh, excuse me. As I say that, it was not Fischetti, excuse me. It was his backup.
Yeah, Luke Thorbon, I think, on that carry there. Interesting to see them not have Fischetti out on the first play of the drive. Usually, if you're going to start off with a run, you want to put it in your bell cow's hands. They're keeping Thorbon out on the field. He's a big dude.
Thorbon, 5'9", 185. Flag comes flying in.
Now they got another running back in, Will Shesky.
Yep, the backup, Will Shesky, as well, out of Scituate, Massachusetts. So looking, illegal substitution penalty will cost the Williams East 5 yards. Looks like some of that running back maneuvering may have contributed.
Yeah, interesting to see. Williams has not involved wide receiver holding Gehring at all today. On the season so far, he's got 193 yards and 2 touchdowns, but 0 catches, and I'm not even sure if he has a target today.
This time a designed run, it looks like, from McHugh. Tries to find the edge, and he does. Will gain around 6 yards past the 30-yard line. So
a nice little pickup on second down, but it looked a little shaky in the backfield. I'm not sure if it
was a
designed
run.
I couldn't tell. It looked like there was a miscommunication. Again, this is what happens when you have your backup running backs in with the quarterback, especially a new quarterback. Just not a lot of communication. Seemed like McHugh might have just pulled that one and took it for himself for a nice pickup.
So Thorbon remains in the game at running back. Got Holden Gehring split out wide. Maybe giving Fischetti a breather. Now
yeah.
Third and six. Tufts looking to rush the passer. Pressure comes quickly, but the offensive line stays up. That ball is incomplete, throwing across the field to who else but Brady Stileski. Couldn't find the completion, and a quick three and out-ish for Williams.
Yeah, I don't necessarily agree with the play script by Williams on that drive. You go two sort of mid-tier running plays. Your second one seemed like it was a broken play, and your quarterback scrambled and helped you out a little bit. And then on third and short or third and medium, you don't really help your quarterback out. You run two deep routes. One was a corner on the left side, and the other was a streak on the right side, and you force your quarterback to put it in the hands of your tight end on a short out route. He had one option.
Punt is up. Another good punt. Really, it has been a good game. And Andre Smith backpedals to fair catch that punt, and it will be Tufts possession. 9 minutes, 37 seconds left. Up 18 points. You think you don't want to put the ball in harm's way, but you might want to keep trying to run that score up.
Well, it's worth noting that score is a tiebreaker in standings oftentimes. So if at the end of the season Tufts is tied in record with another NESCAC team, I believe points four helps boost you above the other team. So you never fully want to take your foot off the gas, but up 18, you feel pretty comfortable.
We've seen momentum be a big part of these seasons in past years. 2 years ago, Jumbo started off pretty poorly to start the season, but once they put their foot on the gas, they really didn't let it back up. And I think this is the type of game where there's no reason to take your foot off the gas. So under 10 minutes left, and the Jumbos have playmakers on offense. See if they continue to go back to them. Berluti again. Going to hand it off quickly to Reese. He has running room, cuts inside, spin move, makes another move. Breaking tackles down past the first down yard line. What a run from Chartellus Reese. Continues to make plays down in and down out.
It's constantly requiring 5 or 6 Williams defensive players to bring him down. He has elusive speed, and he's also he's really slick. He's not a small running back. He shakes off guys really easily. And you saw in that 12, 15-yard pickup right there that it's going to take 4 or 5 guys every time.
I mean, he is 6'2", 200 pounds. You do not find very many running backs in the NESCAC at that height, that size, that speed. My question is, where was he the last 2 years? He's really a dynamic player on offense. He has played on defense before as well, and it's just proving clearly to be one of the most dynamic players on this Tufts team. This time, they fake it to him. Berluti has room on the right side on the read option. He slides down. gain of around 5. Probably the right choice both to keep the ball there and to slide. No more head-first dives.
Yeah, I completely agree. And it's one of those, you're up 18. You don't need to be diving head-first for the first down anymore. Of course, he probably could have gone into contact and maybe picked up 3 or 4 extra yards. But you have the game in the bag. Don't injure your star player.
I'm with you 100%. They're back up to the line rather quickly. Reese still in the backfield. Richardson split out wide to the left. Extra offensive lineman in the game. Reludi takes the signals from the sideline. Clock is ticking, 8:15. Moves Reese over to his left. Takes a snap and hands it off to Reese. Breaks contact immediately, makes a move, and gets down past the first down marker. Another dynamic run. He just is making people miss left and right.
Yeah, and he would have continued that run on a little further if he hadn't stepped out of bounds on the right side. Looked like he still had a lot of momentum. This Williams team really has no answer for the Tufts rushing attack. And at this point, it's too little too late. I don't know if there's anything they can do to come back into this one.
So Richardson, 3 touchdowns on the day, remains on the field. Have to wonder, are they going to look for him again? His defender is wisely, Wyatt Cotton, his defender is wisely several yards off the line of scrimmage, does not want to give up a deep shot yet again, and Berluti doesn't like what he sees, calls a timeout. We've seen that before. At this point in the game, maybe the right call. Always would rather have the right look on the field than risk a mistake.
Yeah, but so far they got 220 yards on the ground combined between Berluti and Reese. Berluti with 16 rushing attempts and Reese with 21 himself. That's excellent from Tufts, and that's something that we really didn't see all that much last year or in the opener against Trinity. Tufts wasn't a run-first team necessarily. They were always a pass-first team. But with 41 combined rushing attempts compared to Tufts' only 31 passing attempts, it's a different script from Jay Civetti this year. He's mixing it up a little bit more. More offensive looks. Makes it much tougher on the defense to defend when you don't know out of every set if it's going to be a run or a pass.
It really seems like over the last 2 weeks, the rushing attack has really become the identity of this team. Now, that's not to say it hasn't been in the past. Tyler Johnson was a big part of the offense in past years, but it was Berluti who broke the tough single-season passing record last year. It was Phil Lutz who broke the single-season receiving yards record. But now, the last 2 weeks, we've really seen running the ball can get you very far in the NESCAC. Now under 8 minutes and a big lead for the Jumbos. Another handoff to Reese. Not too much to gain right there, maybe 3.
Yeah,
Khalid Calhoun, not Chartellus Reese. Hard to tell sometimes with these running backs. We're pretty far away up in the booth.
Yeah, it gets a little tricky, especially when they tuck their numbers up.
Yeah, I think I can just now recognize that. But it is Khalid Calhoun, his 3rd carry of the day. His 4th carry of the day. He has 16 yards on 4 carries, so they're mixing it up late in the game now.
Yeah, it's a good time to start rotating in some guys who maybe did not see as much action earlier in the game. Especially at running back, you can get your second or third string guy in there pretty easily.
Berluti fakes the handoff, looks right, has a man downfield, a leaping grab from Cade Moore. Complete for the first down. An unbelievable catch. Berluti slung that off of his back foot, and Cade Moore made a play.
Yeah, awesome connection from Berluti to Cade Moore. Sort of a little flood play there. Naked rollout to his right side, his good throwing side. Cade Moore on a drag route across the field. Had him the whole time. Cade Moore had to step on his DB and fit it into a tight window. Excellent catch by Cade Moore.
You put the ball up there and your playmakers make plays. So even with a lead, even with the clock ticking, Tufts not afraid to throw the ball downfield as they have done throughout the game. Fleckner on the left side of the field. Richardson out right. Khalid Calhoun in the backfield. Berluti keeps it on the read option. He's got plenty of room down the left side, and he will slide right around the first down marker. If they keep biting on the read option, he's going to keep taking those yards time and time again.
Yeah, absolutely, and there's nobody out there. They had Fleckner run off the safety and Richardson run off the DB as well. There's no one out on the left side. Berluti alone over there forces the free safety to come over and make a play on him. Great little baseball slide by Berluti. Looked like he was stealing second.
May have learned that from his teammate, Henry Fleckner. Some sliding practice going on right now, but under 6 minutes now. They are going to call him short of the first down marker. So 2nd and 2 on the 27-yard line. Calhoun remains in the backfield, and he will get the ball up the middle. Fights, breaks a tackle, and is tackled for the first down. James Hemmer in on the tackle for Williams, but unable to get the stop, and the Jumbos keep on rolling.
Yeah, and with about 5 minutes left on the clock, you're almost ready to start looking ahead towards next week, and Tufts has Bowdoin away at Bowdoin, and Bowdoin last week shut out this Williams team 20-0, so that should be a real good ground and pound game. Should be gritty between the both teams.
Yes, indeed, and it is a night game, October 7th, 6:30, so exciting matchup next week. Williams will be facing Middlebury at 2 p.m., so both matchups to look out for as Berluti fires over the middle. He's got Jaden Richardson, who drags defenders down to the 5-yard line. He almost pulled them all the way in for a touchdown, but Richardson, the connection with Berluti remains strong.
Yeah, he was hungry for that fourth touchdown on the day. Took three defensive guys to drag him down. Thought he was going to break free and get in there. You know, I would love to see them, after such effort on a play like that, you want to see him go right back to Richardson and maybe get him another one.
So now, first and goal, and you've got plenty of options here for the Jumbos. Under 5 minutes, see what they do. Try to get the score up above 30 for the second time this year. Hand off to Khalid Calhoun. He is swarmed after a gain of around 2, and that will bring up second down and goal.
Yeah, had the goal line package in there for Tufts. Looks like 8 big boys up front. They had Richardson spread out to the right, and then Berluti and Calhoun in the backfield. More often than not, if you're Williams, you're guessing that's always a run play. But maybe Tufts will get a little bit greedy and throw up a fade route to Richardson. You never know.
Yeah, you really don't. You never know what they're going to do right here. But look how many offensive linemen they have in the game. I mean, as they move 3 guys to the right side, including Richie Ferrelli, the linebacker, in to block. That is a handoff to Calhoun. Makes a jump cut, forces his way forward, but again, will be just a little bit short.
You notice when they motion all 3 of those guys there, Williams defense, all were screaming to each other, pointing their fingers. This is something that Tufts hasn't run the last 2 weeks. They have not shown this little flip field motion package with their big offensive linemen. So when you're a defense and you have no idea that this is coming, the first time you see it, you know, it's understandable that you don't know how to defend against it. But now this is about your, you know, 10th or 11th time facing the same package. And this time they flip 3 guys, you know, keep the defense guessing. They're doing it again.
Yet again, they flip the 3 extra offensive linemen. Williams looks to adjust. Berluti this time takes it himself, tries to get the corner and dives, but comes up short. He'll be down to the 1-yard line. So a designed run for the quarterback there, putting him a little bit in harm's way. Calhoun remained in the game at running back, not Chartellus Reese, and now it is 4th down. Sportsmanship rules would say you kick a field goal here, but not sure if that's going to be the choice. I think you really want your offense to keep going, and 4th and short, might as well punch it
in.
Yeah,
sportsmanship rules, schmortsmanship rules. Go for the touchdown here. Who cares? Put it in.
I think either way, if you go for it on 4th down and you don't get it, it's such a long field for Williams. 2 minutes left. Yeah. It is the right choice to go for it right here. See if they just run back the same play again. Jumbo set in the game. Ferrelli in as an extra blocker. He's going to hand it off to Calhoun, and he's going to come up short. He's going to come up just short. A big stand from the defense right there, and some momentum at least going forward. That was Anthony Scala from Selden, New York, in on the tackle from Williams. So a turnover on downs. They're 2nd of the game, and now Williams will get the ball back on the 1-yard line with 2 minutes left to go in the game.
Yeah, the situation is pretty dire. You're down 3 possessions. You're on your own 1-yard line. That's why you got to go for it there if you're Tufts. It doesn't cost you anything. You kick a field goal, so what? Now you're up 21. As opposed to 18. Here, you're putting them in a bad spot. You know, if you didn't convert on the touchdown, you still have them pinned against their own end. Would not be surprised if Tufts sends a lot of pressure from their middle linebackers here.
I'm guessing run from Williams.
That's a good guess, Jared.
It is a run. He does make his way out of the end zone and down to around the 3-yard line.
Yeah, it's always a scary feeling when you're standing in that backfield and you're looking down at your feet and you're seeing the color of your opponent team on your feet rather than green gas. That means you're in a tough spot. Good to get out of the end zone, and at least then now they can stand on their own 1-yard line rather than in the opposing end zone.
And that was John Orris on the run. So interesting, both teams seem to have sent their star running backs to the bench. Don't want to risk anything late in this game. Orris remains in the backfield with McHugh.
With Fischetti, though, he was out on the last drive, too. I'm not sure if something's up.
Another run for Orris, and he's down after a gain of around three. Clock continues to run as we approach the end of the game here at the Ellis Oval.
Yeah, it seems like they're just going to run out the clock here and try to avoid injury almost. Wouldn't be surprised to see him come right back to that same inside zone play on third and medium.
Third and four. It is a pass. Looking out quickly, that ball is caught and immediately decked. Harshberger, Paul Harshberger on the catch, the senior out of Schuylerville. And that will be enough for a first down. So the drive continues, but the game will not continue for much longer. Under 30 seconds now.
Yeah, clock stops when you get a first down, so rushing back up to the ball and hopefully get another pass in here.
Ball is snapped low and handed off. A little bit of room, but taken down quickly, and that will likely be the end of the game here in Medford. The Tufts Jumbos leading and going to win this ball game by a score of 28-10. Williams seems intent on taking another play. As the clock ticks down to zero, they do get the snap off. It is a handoff, and he will be taken down after a gain of around four. That brings us to the end of this football match. 28-10 in favor of the Jumbos is your final score here from Medford. A dominant victory in an impressive offensive showing. Michael Berluti, 23 for 33, 265 yards and three touchdowns. On the ground, 18 attempts for 120 yards for Berluti. Jaden Richardson, a big game through the air, 10 receptions, 153 yards, and three touchdowns. And, of course, Chartellus Reese backing up his big game from last week, 21 carries, 104 yards, and one touchdown. That's 28 points for the Jumbos. Could have been more if not for a couple turnover on downs. The defense stood tall. Williams stayed in the game throughout, a hard, gritty game from them, but the Jumbos walk out with a win.
Yeah, if you're the Jumbos, you're feeling pretty good now after two back-to-back wins. These are wins in great fashion, too. They weren't even close all game. Last week against Bates, it was never close. This week, you know, after the end of the first half, down up only 7 points for the Jumbos, but they only extended a lead and didn't allow Williams to really do much else the rest of the game. So going forward, looking at Bowdoin, I really think Tufts have to feel confident going into that matchup. Although it's an away game, Tufts has looked great at home the last 2 weeks. So hopefully by the time they come back to us 2 weeks from now, we'll continue this streak of success.
And we will be on the call for that game as well, so we'll see you back. So hypnotic, magical. Versus Wesleyan University, but coming off today, a lot to like for the Jumbos and for Williams, a lot to build on, some strong gains through the air and through the ground, just unable to do it consistently. So all in all, quite the entertaining game here from Medford. This has been Jared Cohen and Henry Burns for JumboCast. We will be coming back briefly, hopefully with an interview for you guys, but until then, we are signing off. Everyone, please stay home safely. Magical,
Hi, I'm here post-game with Jumbo's star wide receiver, Jaden Richardson. Jaden, obviously a phenomenal performance, 3 touchdowns. Can you walk us through what was going through your head after that second ridiculous catch?
We had to get the job done. I think last week was a good thing. We know what happened against Trinity. I think just for us, which wasn't taking our foot off the gas and keeping it going.
Obviously, first 2 drives, not great, had to punt. But the remainder of the game, only 1 punt in the remaining 8 drives. What was the message in between those second and third drives that led to the offensive transformation?
Just focusing on the little things. We were like 2 yards short in each of those drives. So I think for us, it was kind of just making sure we finished off the drives and did our jobs. Yeah.
Obviously, this, I mean, at least for the first half, was the quintessential NESCAC game. Hard fought between 2 very determined teams. Can you talk a little bit about what it means to be a NESCAC athlete?
Yeah, I think for us, it's having the ability to kind of go to one of the best universities in the country. But also be able to play a really high level of football. I think that's the one thing that we all kind of looking for schools and an opportunity we have here.
Well, we definitely saw a high level of football today. Thank you so much, Jaden, and thank all of you for tuning in. As always, stay home safely.